This is ESPN Rivalry Week, presented by Samsung Mobile.
The eye of the Tiger is focused and intense as Rivalry Week continues on ESPNU. The Jackson State Tigers face off against their heated rivals, the Alcorn State Braves, in the Capital City Classic on ESPNU. Next. Welcome to ESPNU College Football presented by Allstate. Jackson State and Alcorn State in one of the most intense and long-held rivalries in all of college football meet in the Capital City Classic here in Jackson, Mississippi. Jackson State's Tigers have already won the Eastern Division of the SWAC, and they are headed to their second straight SWAC championship game, which will be played in Birmingham on December 13th against an opponent which has yet to be decided. Hi, everyone. Welcome inside the Veterans Memorial Stadium here in Jackson, along with my partner, Eddie Robinson, Jr. I'm Dwayne Ballen. Couple of teams here, partner, going in different directions, but it doesn't mean a whole lot because this is Rivalry Week and this is a serious game.
Yeah, the Capital City Classic, this is always a big weekend around here. And if you're head coach Rick Comegee for Jackson State, of course you were brought here to win the SWAC championship. He's done that. But if the head coach of Jackson State is also expected to beat Alcorn State. Now, coach Alcorn State's Ernest Jones, this is his first year as head coach, but he's played in this rivalry in 93 and 94, of course, with Steve McNair. He's never lost to Jackson State, so he'll try to get that type of knowledge and wisdom to his team so they can play hard today.
And for Jackson State, defensively, two outstanding performers.
Yeah, you have to start, of course, with Marcellus Speaks. This guy is outstanding. He leads the FCS in tackles for loss. He likes to play the run. Very smart, intelligent player. He'll be all over the field for the Jackson State Tigers. Of course, his counterpart is defensive end Marcus Bernard. Marcus Bernard is a very intense player. He has 14 sacks going into this game, and he has a chance to become the all-time sack leader for Jackson State. These two players put together have a very intense front seven, probably the best in all of FCS.
And those two will be chasing around an all-everything quarterback for Alcorn State, Tim Buckley.
Yeah, Tim Buckley, he's a young quarterback, but he's really coming into his own. He's starting to throw the ball downfield a little better now, but his biggest attribute is his running ability. 428 yards rushing. You have to contain him if you're the Jackson State Tigers to have an effective day.
A renewal of old rivals. Kickoff from Jackson when we return on ESPNU. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate, proud sponsor of college football and the 75th Allstate Sugar Bowl. Are you in good hands? And Samsung, proud sponsor of ESPN Rivalry Week. Veterans Memorial Stadium is crowded, and Steve McNair, one of the greatest to ever play in the SWAC, Alcorn State quarterback from 1990 to 1994, was out for the coin toss. These two teams have been meeting for quite some time now. 63rd time, Jackson State leading at 38-23-1. Alcorn State, though, has won four of the last five. Dallas Comegee is the head coach for Jackson State. Rick Comegee is the head coach for Jackson State, third year. 20-13 overall, 2007 SWAC Coach of the Year. Just a few moments ago, here was Ernest T. Jones, the head coach for Alcorn State, in the locker room.
To be proud when you go out today. I want you to play with pride today. I want you to be proud to be wearing the Alcorn hat. Play with that pride when you get out there. Every play you play, play with pride. Every snap you play, play with pride. Show that pride when you get out there on that football field today. I want you to do this for me today, man. I want you to have fun. Go out there and have fun. Don't be afraid to make mistakes, man. Just play. Go out there and play the game of your lives. Play with pride.
Ernest Jones, 1995 alum of Alcorn State on that 95 SWAC team, Eddie, and it means a lot to him to come out here in his first year and lead this team into this game. Opening moments, Alcorn State tries an onside kick.
And it is recovered by Jackson State. Interesting, Alcorn State won the opening toss, deferred, and then tried a bit of trickery to get it on the opening series. Trey Rutland will lead the Jackson State Tigers offensive unit out on the field. 6'3", 239-pound junior from Atlanta. Number 7 in total offense in the SWAC, 173 yards per game he's averaging. He leads the team in passing and rushing. You really have to be on your P's and Q's because he can do it land or by air.
Well, Trey Rutland, I mean, he settled down to become the starting quarterback at Jackson State midway through the year. And once he realized that he can actually run the football effectively, he's been a very changed quarterback.
Jackson State will begin the game at the 43-yard line of Alcorn State. In the backfield for Jackson State, number 29, Luther Edwards. He's the team's second leading rusher, leads them in touchdowns. He gets it left side into the secondary, and he's off. He is finally dragged down by Corey McLaurin, number 22. But not after a big opening run from scrimmage.
A great start by Jackson State, and this is what the Tigers fans want. They feel like they can match up well against this Alcorn State defense. And you can see just a simple play by Luther Edwards with the speed and the power to get deep within Alcorn State's territory.
That sets up a first and goal in the opening moments of the game for Jackson State. Tigers come into this one having won 5 straight games. Keep it on the ground. That was Edward Lee, the fullback. Take a look at the Jackson State offensive line. They are anchored by Mikhail Horshaw, who is an all-conference performer, number 76 at right tackle. The backs and receivers, you've already seen Edwards. Keep your eye on number 4, Carlos Simpson, when they decide to go to the air. So, Eddie, here we are, opening series. Jackson State already knocking at the door for Alcorn State, which has a defensive unit that has really been tested this year.
You have to be tough in the red zone. If you can hold them to 3 points, it'll be a big victory for Alcorn.
Second and goal for Jackson State, wearing white. Rutland decides to keep it left side. He's into the end zone. Touchdown, Tigers. Didn't take him long.
Didn't take him long. That's his 4th rushing touchdown on the year. Like you said earlier, he leads Jackson State in rushing. Just a designed quarterback run behind the offensive lineman and the running back.
Rutland has done a good job leading this offense from both sides, whether it's by running or by passing. Brett Bennett on for the extra point. It's good, and the Tigers lead it 7-0.
You can tell it's just a counter. Just a counter play. You pull the backside guard, and the running back really didn't have anyone to block at number 7. Trey Rutland pretty much goes into the end zone untouched, but this is a big kid. I mean, he goes 6'3", 230 pounds, so that little hand tackle definitely is not going to stop a quarterback like Trey Rutland.
Only took the Jackson State Tigers 3 plays, 43 yards, a minute, 19 seconds. Of course, the highlight was a 37-yard run by Luther Edwards, which set up a point-blank shot for Jackson State.
You know, when we talked with Coach Jones yesterday, one thing he said was that we have to be able to overcome the early adversity. I mean, you try the onside kick and it doesn't work. I like the call because you're the underdog and you have to make something big happen for your team, but now you're down 7-0. So how did your team respond early? You can't get into the, oh, here we go again mode. You have to respond and make a big play if you're Alcorn State.
So now if you're Alcorn State, you're 2-9 on the year, and your top rival, which already is into the championship game for the conference, has just jumped on you and jumped on you hard.
Well, I think you just settled down. I mean, you're only down 7 points. There's so much more football to play. You still call a very aggressive game plan, and you can get right back into this thing.
McLaurin fields the kickoff. Down the right side. He's tackled at the 30-yard line. First man to get to him was number 17, Ryan Rich, the linebacker. So for the first time, we will see the Alcorn State offensive unit. They are led by Mr. Buckley, whom we spoke of few moments ago, 1,771 yards, 8 touchdown passes. Ernest Jones is very pleased with the way he has learned this new offense that he has implemented in his first season as head coach. Now, are those jitters right there on the offensive end for Alcorn State, or are they out of whack because they're down 7-0 off the bat?
I think Alcorn will be okay. I mean, you take a look at Buckley. I mean, he was going back and forth from being the starter, not the starter, but this guy has really taken over this offense and has taken ownership of him. I mean, he watches a lot of film during the week. He prepares well, and they feel like his best football is ahead of him. He's still a young player who's learning the game.
You see the interesting formation of receivers at the top of your screen. And now it goes back to the quarterback, Tony Hobson, number 6. Hobson, the backup quarterback, a senior from right here in Jackson at Jim Hill. Alcorn's offensive line led by Bronson Carvalho. He's a senior from Hawaii, number 71. Backs and receivers, Devarius Pilcher, 453 yards, 4 touchdowns coming into the game. So that play picked up 6 yards. Defensively, Jackson State wasn't fooled at all. So we've seen a little bit of everything from Alcorn State in just the first few plays of this opening offensive set for them. It hasn't worked well.
But I like it. I mean, I like the aggressive play calls that the Braves are using today. You have to try to do something. I mean, this defense is extremely good. They're ranked to the tops of the conference, and you just can't line up and play football with them. You're going to have to come up with some exciting formations, some trick plays in order to move the football.
So that will bring on Alex Elfke to punt away. Mitchell Moten is awaiting the punt for Jackson State. Calls for a fair catch, gets it. And that's where the Tigers will take over. Just inside, they're on 25-yard line, already leading 7-0. The Tigers and the Braves, it's Rivalry Week on ESPNU. Jackson State leading it early.
The Southwestern Athletic Conference.
Today's college football game on ESPNU is presented in high definition. Opening moments of the first quarter, Rivalry Week, presented by Samsung. Jackson State, 7-0. Look at our impact player. Today's impact player is brought to you by Taco Bell.
Yeah, Lee Robinson for Alcorn State already has 100 tackles on the year, the inspirational leader for this Alcorn State defense. And, of course, Trey Rutland. You've already seen him today with a rushing touchdown. He can also do it through the air.
Jackson State opens up a second offensive set out of the shotgun. Edwards over the right side, couple of yards.
Clint Mosley did a great job of making that tackle on the perimeter. That play seemed like it had 10 or 15 yards in it, and he chopped it down for a gain of 1.
Mosley, a senior from Capitol Heights, Maryland, transfer from Laney College. 50 tackles coming into this game for the season. Puts him number 3 on the team in tackles. Second and 9 for Jackson State. First time to the air goes Rutland, has a receiver. That's his tight end, Marcel Frost. Defensively for Alcorn State up front, keep your eyes on number 90, Malcolm Taylor. He came into this game with 4 sacks. Linebackers, of course, led by Mr. Robinson. It's his neighborhood. 100 tackles makes him 4th in the conference. In the secondary, Italy Etienne is the man number 2 that leads that unit. Eight-yard pickup sets up 3rd and 1 for Jackson State, already leading 7-0. Edwards picks up the first down over the left side. Ball is loose on the field, and it is recovered by Alcorn State, so the Braves get their first break of the game. Lee Robinson, number 56, making it happen.
And you expect him to be in the middle of any type of traffic for that Alcorn State defense, and this is exactly what they need. Down 7-0, things aren't going your way. Somebody has to step up and make a play outside of the X's and O's. Just a simple counter play. You can see the big offensive guard pulling around. Of course, he had the ball in the wrong hand, and I think that's what caused the fumble. Luther Edwards was carrying that football in his right hand, and that just exposes it to the inside play. It looked like number two, Edley Etienne, was the one who caused the fumble, and Alcorn State's back in business.
So the Braves from the 40 of Jackson State, their second shot offensively in this game early in the first quarter. Keep it on the ground. Joshua Brumfield, number 23, a sophomore. Tackled by Marcus Bernard, we'll call his name a lot. Number 80, senior from Ypsilanti, Michigan, Grand Rapids Community College. 69 tackles coming into this one. Last week, he had 17 tackles and 5 sacks. 6 yards on the play. Alcorn State keeping it on the ground, getting close to a first down. Defensively for Jackson State, there is more than Mr. Speaks and Mr. Bernard up front. Along that defensive line, Sam Washington, number 50, 6 forced fumbles this year. Linebackers, Timothy Clark is also very active. Rich has 42 tackles coming into the game. And in the secondary, Malcolm Palmer, number 26, is an all-conference performer, earned those honors last year as a strong safety and now playing free safety. 4-yard pickup. It is now first down, Alcorn State. Buckley running left side, has room. Another first down for Alcorn State. And so far on the ground is the way to go for the Braves. Malcolm Palmer coming up with the tackle for Jackson State.
And this Jackson State defense, they're only giving up 74 yards per game on the ground. This is a good, well-designed play because you have a speedy quarterback in Timothy Buckley. You get him to the edge of that defense. The toughness of that Jackson State defense is down the middle with Coit and Marcellus Speaks. If you can get around the corner to the edge, you can have some big plays in the rushing game.
12-yard pickup. Another first down for Alcorn State, which trails early on 7-0 to its arch rival. We're in Jackson, Mississippi.
Dwayne, I'm going to tell you what, this is a huge shock to me that Alcorn State can just line up and play football and move Jackson State's defense off of the field. Because you look at how tough this Jackson State defense is, especially Alcorn State, they aren't ranked very high in rushing yards, total yards, or points. You can tell, I mean, there's only 118 FCS teams, and they're pretty low at those categories. So they're doing a great job in this first quarter just running the football.
Brumfield again up the middle, gets closer, has another first down. Now it is going to be first and goal for Alcorn State. This does seem like a different offense on the second offensive series. Sam Washington defensively there for Jackson State.
I mean, the front seven, they play more of a front eight, more of a 4-4 for Jackson State. I mean, they've been great all year long. And they haven't had trouble stopping anyone running the football. So I know they're somewhat surprised that Alcorn State has chosen to run the football, first of all, and they're so effective early in the game.
First and goal for Mr. Buckley and the rest of the Braves from the 7-yard line. Brumfield once again.
Brumfield again on the carry down inside the box.
Brumfield, a sophomore from Flowood, Mississippi. Northwest Rankin High, not very tall, but he is big, 5'10", 200 pounds. So when he gets inside, it's hard to bring him down, as Malcolm Palmer found out on that play.
Look at all the different style of plays that Alcorn is running today. Most of them are misdirection and counter plays, trying to slow down those Jackson State linebackers.
Second and goal. Great defensive alertness and awareness. And that was Marcus Bernard who got to him first.
And this is what happens when you just run the toss. I mean, look at the speed and the guys up front. They diagnose and read extremely well. Yeah, you see Marcus Bernard and Speaks and those guys, you have to run some type of counter, some type of distraction to slow them down. It's very hard just to run a toss against a team with the size and strength and the speed that this Jackson State defense has.
Loss of one on the play as Brumfield exits the game. He is replaced by DeVars Pilcher, number five. Puts third and goal. Buckley, under pressure. Gets it away, up in the air, intercepted in the end zone by Jackson State. Ryan Rich, the sophomore from Pensacola, comes up with his second interception of the game, and Eddie Robinson Jr. couldn't have come in a more timely moment for the Jackson State defensive unit.
Yeah, Buckley, at first this play was defended well. He's just trying to make a play, and this is a great job, first of all, by number six, Dominique Johnson, of tapping the ball in the air, and then 14 Rich, he comes up and makes the pick.
How deflating is that if you're Alcorn State?
That's almost like a volleyball play. If you looked at what Dominique Johnson did, he couldn't catch it, but did a great job of tapping it, but Alcorn can bounce back.
Ryan Rich having a seat after coming up with that timely interception for Jackson State in the end zone. So if you're Alcorn State, now you are in a tough situation because this offensive unit is coming back out for Jackson State. It's been a tale of two seasons, Eddie.
Yeah, it absolutely has. And the biggest thing you have to look at is the turnover margin. Of course, you said they were minus six to start off with in the first five games, and then the last five games you're plus six, and that a lot of that has to do with quarterback Trey Rutland. He was throwing interceptions early on. He's controlled that problem.
First play from scrimmage on this series for Jackson State, and markers are down on the field. Jackson State last week defeated Alabama A&M 37-21. Referee George McCullum heads up our officiating crew today.
Replay, first down.
Offsides called against Alcorn State. Ernest Jones thinking about the job that lies ahead in rebuilding his alma mater's unit. Continuing that theme with the tale of two seasons, Trey Rutland, first five games, the eight interceptions, none over the last five. Great defensive job by Alcorn State. Etienne was into the backfield quickly from his strong safety position to make the tackle.
And we talked with Trey Rutland yesterday, and one thing he talked about, I mean, he's not getting sacked as much, he's not throwing as many interceptions because he's running a lot more. When he doesn't see anything open down the field, he's tucking the ball and moving. We say, well, hey, what happened? What made you start running the football? He said, quite frankly, I got tired of getting sacked, got tired of getting beat up on and hit. So when I don't see anyone open downfield, hey, I take off running.
Loss of three on that previous play, so it is now second and 13 for Jackson State. Leading 7-0 here in the first quarter in Jackson. Rutland under trouble and going down. Malcolm Taylor comes up with his fifth sack of the season. Big junior from Brooksville, Mississippi.
Yeah, just a good job here. Coverage downfield. No one open early on. Trey Rutland tries to use his running ability, and Malcolm Taylor, realizing I have to get this guy down, did a good job of taking the correct angle and not letting the quarterback get outside the pocket.
Randy Carter, number 49, was also there. But Taylor, 6'3", 245 pounds, anchoring that defensive line for Alcorn State, which has been tested a lot this year. Loss of nine on the play. Now third and very long. Markers down again on the field. Opening drive of the game offensively for Jackson State. Scored. Ball start against Jackson State. So the miscues are now on the side of the Tigers.
If you're Alcorn State, if you can hold them on this third down attempt right here, you should get pretty good field position after the punt.
Trey Rutland in a deep hole working out of the shotgun formation inside his 4-yard line. Under pressure, and he's going down again. The second sack of the game already for Alcorn State. And guess who's at the bottom of it once again? Malcolm Taylor, number 90.
Yeah, Malcolm Taylor from Brookfield, Mississippi is off to a great start in this Capital City Classic. They're trying to run the screen at the bottom of the screen, and he just comes around in too much speed. He's able to get the sack, his second of the day. Great recognition by the Alcorn State defense.
Back to punt in his own end zone. Jackson State punter Brett Bennett barely got off that high snap. Gets a favorable roll for Jackson State, but Alcorn State will have very good field position to begin its offensive set. Malcolm Taylor and his teammates very fired up on the sidelines. Pretty good defensive stand by Alcorn State. So their offensive teammates will get the opportunity to try and even the score when we come back.
Seat movers, that's what you'd call us.
We'd buy seats up in the nosebleeds and then move down.
We'd look for no-shows.
Who sometimes did show.
Soda spillers.
That is gonna leave a stain.
And then we'd swoop right in for the perfect seats. Hello.
And goodbye.
Want great seats? Your city card could get them. And now, every time you use a participating city card, you're in it for a chance to go on a 3-city tour with Nickelback. Want the story of a lifetime? Your city card can help you write it.
Be whoever you want to be at ESPNU with friends.
Friends are cool.
And college sports.
Sports are cool.
Reach for the stars because you just might touch them. Together there's nothing we can't do. ESPNU.
Shaping the future.
Why do hardwood floors cost less at Lumber Liquidators? At most flooring stores, your floor makes a few stops before you get your order. Lumber Liquidators cuts out the middleman. Come on in. You'll find the quality hasn't been cut, just the prices.
Right now at Lumber Liquidators, get Bella Wood pre-finished solid oak flooring with a 50-year warranty starting at $350 a square foot. The same floor home improvement expert Bob Vila has in his home.
Hi, I'm Bob Vila. I like the quality of the flooring so much that I've put it in my own home.
Supreme horizontal natural bamboo pre-finished flooring as low as $199 a square foot. Comparable items are sold elsewhere for $389 a square foot. And Dream Home laminate flooring starts at only 69 cents a square foot. Plus, you can floor now and pay later because everything at Lumber Liquidators is available with no down payment, no payment, no interest for 12 months. For the best deals anywhere on hardwood floors, visit any location, lumberliquidators.com, or call 1-800-HARDWOOD.
Welcome back to the Capital City Classic in Jackson, Mississippi. 7-0, Jackson State leading, 3:51 remaining in the first quarter. After the 44-yard punt by Bennett, Alcorn State takes over at its own 48-yard line. Timothy Buckley at quarterback. Calls his own number, left side, trying to get outside, cannot do so. He is corralled and brought down. First man to him was number 14, Ryan Rich, the sophomore linebacker from Pensacola. ESPNU delivers ACC college football action later today as the Duke Blue Devils head to Blacksburg to take on Frank Beamer's Virginia Tech Hokies. College football primetime presented by Citi on ESPNU and ESPNU HD today at 5:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. Along with Eddie Robinson Jr., our entire ESPNU crew, I'm Dwayne Ballin in Jackson, Mississippi. 63rd meeting between these two heated rivals. On second down, Buckley goes to the air as a receiver. Michael Mosley, the tight end, the junior from Cleveland, Mississippi, with the reception.
Crucial third down for Alcorn State. They haven't been really good in this area all year long, but you have to convert these third downs, especially so you don't give Jackson State's offense a lot of time to attack that defense. They'll start to wear you down with that running game if you don't convert your own third downs.
4-yard pickup gets Alcorn State into Jackson State territory. Third down. Buckley out of the shotgun. Receiver had it momentarily and dropped it. That was Edward Johnson, the sophomore from Natchez.
He was open for a second, but here you see number 56, Marcellus Speaks. When he doesn't catch it cleanly, and this guy knows how to deliver big hits and finish off plays. That ball should have been caught for the first down, but give Speaks credit for being right there on the spot to defend the play.
For the first time today, we'll see the Alcorn State punter, Alex Elfke, set to kick away, averaging 39 yards per punt this season. Mouton moves away. Has been an interesting year, and it is ongoing in the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Jackson State here repeating once again as the Eastern Division champs.
Yeah, but look in the West. I mean, you have three teams in the running for the title still. I mean, you have the Prairie View Panthers, 9-1 record, the most wins since 1964, but it still doesn't guarantee you a spot in the championship game. Grambling State and Southern still high in that spot.
Jackson State opens up this offensive series on the ground. Luther Edwards with the carry. Standings in both divisions, you know, we talked about the East at the top of the telecast, but the West, a lot can happen.
Yeah, a lot can happen because Grambling State plays Southern in that big Bayou Classic game at the end of the year. If Southern should win that game, you would have a three-way tie between Grambling State, Prairie View, and Southern. We'll talk later on how they'll figure out that tiebreaker.
Keep your notepads handy, folks, because there's a lot to talk about. Four-yard pickup on that previous play sets up second and six. Edwards barely got back to the line of scrimmage before he was grabbed by Brandon Morris, number 93.
I expect Jackson State to be patient. They're going to really try to run this football early on, establish the run, then they'll come into some play-action pass later, because they know you have to run the football well in this type of game. You can't just become pass-happy. Trey Rutland has done a great job in protecting the football when he has to pass, but it's been because of that good running game to back him up.
Jackson State's first drive was impressive, but the previous two, it's hard for the Tigers to get anything going. Third down and five. Rutland has Simpson out of the backfield, but there are markers down, and we'll wait to hear from George McCullum, our referee, to find out what exactly the transgression was and whom it affects most.
Holy.
We're having some technical difficulties, obviously, with George's microphone, but it was holding against Jackson State, so you take 1 foot forward and two back.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely been a problem somewhat for Jackson State. I mean, you have a big play. You should have completed the first down, but the penalty now sets up a third and 11. And we'll see if Alcorn, last time on third down, they came with a three-man rush. We'll see if they try to bring pressure in this situation, another third down opportunity for their defense.
Brian Jackson, the man split wide to the bottom of your screen, is a speedster. Keep your eye on him. 30 seconds remaining here in the first quarter. Timeout call down on the field. Sunday, ESPNU brings you three college basketball games from the O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off. First at 10:30 a.m. Eastern, it's Fairfield and Tennessee Chattanooga in the seventh place game. Then at 12:30 Eastern, Missouri faces number 20 Southern California in the fifth place game. And at 5 Eastern, Virginia Tech and Seton Hall meet in the third place game. The O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off on ESPNU Sunday. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. College basketball season now in full swing. Here in Jackson, Mississippi, it's Rivalry Week on ESPNU. Jackson State and Alcorn State, a couple of heated rivalries. Jackson State comes into the game 6-4 overall, 5-1 in conference play. Already the Eastern champions. Alcorn State 2-9 overall, 1-5 in conference play, and in last place in the same division. But as we have noted, that really doesn't mean a whole lot in this game, because Alcorn State really is a play or two away from having this game tied.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, and they realize the importance of this football game. Basically, this is their SWAC championship game. If you're Alcorn State, everything that you're gearing towards now is to win this one football game, and the season will seem so much better.
Timeout called once again on the field. Crucial third down and long play for Jackson State coming up. You see Ernest Jones. Alcorn State can lay some of this deficit at their own feet.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you have the young quarterback, Timothy Buckley, not realizing the situation. He should have just tried to run the football. You have a good field goal kicker, and here you can see the drop. This should have been completed for a first down, and those two mistakes have really limited this Alcorn defense. Other than that, they're running the ball extremely well against the Jackson State defense, and they're playing pretty tough against the Tigers.
They are, and it's amazing because Alcorn State is the SWAC's third worst defense, last in pass defense, and frankly, we didn't think Jackson State would have much of a problem after that opening series of moving the ball on this unit.
Well, that first big play, but sometimes what happens when you have a team that's somewhat the better team, and Jackson State is the favorite, I mean, let's not scratch our heads about that, but when you have some early success, your players start to relax a little. It's like, oh, this thing is going to be pretty easy. But Alcorn State, I mean, they're going to play this entire game hard. This is their SWAC championship game, so they're going to give their very best effort of the year.
So after two timeouts, it is third and 11 for Jackson State. Low snap, bobbled, and Rutland has to take off. And he picks up the first down on a busted play. But that's what he does well. Roderick Williams there to stop him, but again, not before the chains are moved.
Yeah, this play was headed for disaster. I mean, the ball is on the ground, and he just can't seem to get a handle for it, so you just do the next best thing. You take off running. Made a very good move against the linebacker, Lee Robinson, and just continue to duck his shoulder to get the first down. He's a big kid, goes 6'3", 220 pounds, so he knows how to run through tackles.
Junior from Atlanta by way of Mississippi Valley State.
Mississippi State.
With all due respect to Mississippi Valley, Mississippi State. You are correct, sir, as Ed McMahon would say. We're through with one quarter here in Jackson, Mississippi. Jackson State leading it, 7-0 on ESPNU.
The Packers.
It's very rare.
We are back and ready for the second quarter between Jackson State and Alcorn State. Rutland looking to the air, is under pressure, and down he goes. Lee Robinson, the leader on that Alcorn State defensive unit, picks up his third and a half sack.
Let's look at Lee Robinson right here. What he's going to do is come around here and pretty much. Lee Robinson that right there with the cross up. Two and a half sacks. That's his third and a half sack after this game. I mean, Lee Robinson is a guy who loves to play the run, but also very physical against the pass as well.
There was a loss of 10 on the play, putting the ball back to the 15-yard line. Robinson, senior from Gloucester, Mississippi. He's the leader on and off the field. Coach Jones told us he's the man that gets everyone up, not only calling the plays defensively, but he's the guy away from the field, it's talking to all the younger players, getting them fired up, getting them ready, understanding what their task is. Second and 20 for Jackson State. Edwards gets out over the 20-yard line, but once again, Alcorn State's defensive unit is putting up a game effort and is settled in. Robinson, one of those there, number 56, leading the way.
Yeah, Robinson is the inspirational leader. This is a guy that Coach Jones, he just glows about. And he's a senior on his team, and he's the leader on and off. So he just stays after practice. He'll talk with the guys in the locker room just about life, about football skills, about having pride playing for Alcorn State. Definitely the type of player you're going to miss when his Braves days, his days playing for Alcorn State are over with.
Carries a 3.0 GPA. Rutland out of the shotgun on third down, looking across the middle, has a receiver. But quickly, the Alcorn State Braves converge. and turned what could have been a significant gain into very little. Carlos Simpson was the receiver, but there were four purple jerseys around him.
And the gang tackling. And this defense, of course, defense coordinator Ernest Collins is in his first year. He came here with Coach Jones and implemented this defensive scheme. And tell you what, you couldn't tell today that they haven't been playing very good defense all year long, as they're playing lights out.
Brett Bennett on the punt. It was botched. He tried to run in Alcorn State, which was bringing the pressure. Defensively, the special teams coming up with a major play to put the offensive unit in a very good situation. Number 35, Jamison Smith, the junior from Madison, leading the way defensively on special teams.
Yeah, punter Brett Bennett, he had time to get it off. He just felt like it would be blocked, so he had to pull it down. And like you said, great play by Alcorn State. Number 35, Jamison Smith, not only forcing the punter to pull it down, but then coming up and making the tackle. Now the Alcorn State Braves are in business. They're at the 24-yard line. They're only down 7-0. We'll see if their offense can put it in the end zone now.
And it's not like Alcorn State hasn't been in some favorable positioning offensively in this game. They just have yet to punch it into the end zone. Timothy Buckley, number 7, leading them out of the shotgun. Calls his own number over the left side. Gets down close to the 20-yard line. No surprise, Marcus Bernard, number 80, one of the men getting up off of him defensively.
Yeah, Marcus Bernard, you have to talk about the week this guy had last week against Alabama A&M. And just from a defensive end spot, you just don't think a guy can make that many big plays with the 17 tackles, with 5 sacks. Just it was all over the football field.
Pickup of about 1.5 yards. Second down at the 22. Brumfield gets the pitch, right side, has running room into the secondary. Alcorn State now inside the 15-yard line. Once again, the Braves on the move within striking distance.
Yeah, the Braves are knocking on the door. We'll see if anyone answers. Yeah, but big third down conversion here.
Pickup of 6 on that play. Third and 2 for Alcorn State. Trailing 7-0 here in Jackson at Memorial Stadium. Very little up the middle. Jackson State's defensive unit not fooled at all.
Yeah, Tim Buckley, the snap was a little hot. He almost lost it. You can see Jackson State, 3 or 4 guys around the football. And they're not just going to have to pick up and run for the first down, so I think Alcorn State's going to bring on their field goal kicker.
We will see Taylor Richardson, who is 11 of 19 on field goals for the year. It's blocked. So special teams for both Jackson State and Alcorn State come through on key plays.
And no surprise, that was number 56, Marcellus Speaks, who put on the pressure and the block for Jackson State.
Special teams coming through for the Tigers here in Jackson.
What is he doing?
Said something about not driving through Texas without getting a shot of a bull.
Guys! Ooh. Maybe we should help him.
First one
under a minute.
Welcome back to Jackson, where Jackson State leads Alcorn State 7-0. Marcellus Speaks just came through in a big way on special teams for Jackson State.
Yeah, we just had a punt block. Now we also have we're going to highlight him right here. See, Marcellus Speaks is just going to come right up the middle right there and pretty much be unblocked. The center never gets a hand on him. I'll tell you who really helps. Number 92, Dennis Coit. He lined up over the guard. They weren't able to step down. Marcellus Speaks gets the easy block. Disgruntled kicker, number 47, Taylor Richardson. And I tell you what, this kid was booting him from 30 and 40 yards with ease at practice yesterday. So I know he felt like he could get that kick through the uprights if it was not blocked by Marcellus Speaks.
Marcellus speaks. A lot of great linebackers have worn the blue and white at Jackson State.
Yeah, one of my all-time favorites, Robert Brazil, good friend of mine. I think he should be in the NFL Hall of Fame. But also Jackie Walker, early round pick with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Darian Connors in the early 90s. He was with the Atlanta Falcons. And, of course, Marlo Perry, drafted in the second round by the Buffalo Bills. If you think of Jackson State, you always think about the great defenses and the great linebackers and the tradition they have. You take a kid like Marcellus Speaks. He's from Jackson, went to Provine High School. His dad actually played for Alcorn, so he grew up cheering for the Alcorn State Braves. But now he's in that long line of traditional good players, linebacker specifically, there at Jackson State.
Entered the game with 106 tackles to lead the conference. First down for Jackson State. Rutland pumps, finally gets it away, has a receiver, a reception for Carlos Simpson. That is a first down for Jackson State. Rutland showing a bit of his ability to get out of harm's way and still make a play.
Yeah, great job of looking downfield, and wow, he just scooped that off the ground. It was a good catch, but it was very close to being incomplete.
Maybe could be a good shortstop. Pickup of 11, ball now at the 36-yard line. Jackson State with the ball, second quarter, 10:02 remaining before half. Eddie, are we certain he caught this?
Well, like you said, he's a shortstop, and they know how to make things look with their arm.
I think he caught it. I think he got it. Pretty good job by Simpson to turn around and then dive for the first down after that. Simpson, a senior from Detroit, transfer from Cincinnati. He's their top receiver. Second down.
This is a very dangerous part of the game if you're Alcorn State, because you're down 7-0. You've gotten a lot of breaks, but you haven't been able to take advantage of them. Here's a situation where your defense has to come in and get off the field in this big third down play so your offense can try to put some points on the board. This Jackson State offense is talented. They can score at any time. If you keep playing around with them, before you know it, you'll be down 14-0 with a very good defense by Jackson State.
Trey Rutland's numbers so far, 34 yards, not a touchdown pass, has not had a pass dropped yet. On third down, he'll tuck it away, run again. He's already picked up a first down in this situation before, has much more as he gets into Alcorn State territory near the 40-yard line, where he was finally stopped by Corey McLaurin, but not before a big pickup.
That's what makes Jackson State and Trey Rutland in particular so hard to defend, because look, you have very good coverage. Everyone is covered downfield, but then you have number 7 who takes off running and not only gets the first down, but picks up like 20 yards.
Pickup of 17 for Rutland. Eddie, you're an old linebacker. How do you defend against a guy like this who can hurt you with his arm or his feet, and you're never sure what he's going to do?
Well, it's tough because you have to cover first. You have to realize that the bigger play is if he throws the pass completion. But then once he starts running, you all have to react and rally to the football. And that last play, the Jackson State receivers did a good job of realizing that the quarterback is running the football. They turned into blockers, and that's how he was able to get the first down.
Rutland now over center on first down. Pitch out is to Edwards, who gets away from two defenders and actually turns the corner, turns what should have been a loss into a pickup. Roderick Williams with the tackle. Pickup of 3 on the play for the freshman from Yazoo City.
Hey, Jackson State going right back to the running game with Luther Edwards. They just want to control this clock, control the football game with the running plays. Let Trey Rutland take his chances in the past. He's been very good at not throwing the interceptions over the last 5 games. He's really matured as a player.
Ball now at the 38-yard line of Alcorn State. As Rick Comagie looks on, his Jackson State Tigers are on the move, already leading 7-0 here in the Capital City Classic. Rutland rolling left. Has a man wide open. And a reception. Cedric Dixon the sophomore from Atlanta, Georgia. All 6 feet, 5 inches of him hauling in the pass.
Now look here, see, they're gonna fake right here, and the quarterback's then gonna roll out to the right. Now this guy right here, the defensive end for Alcorn State, you have to keep contained. You have to realize that you have a runner at the quarterback position. See there, he suckers down and goes with the run fake. Now look at the wide open field for Trey Rutland and the big left-hander, easy throw and completion.
27-yard pickup sets up first down at the 11-yard line for Alcorn. Straight ahead, running from Edwards. He gets into the secondary where he's tackled by Corey McLaurin, who are beginning to call his name a little too much if you're the defensive coordinator for Alcorn State, because that's your cornerback making tackles.
Yeah, you have to have your big guys up front making tackles, but I tell you what, you have to be physical if you're Alcorn State, because this Jackson State offensive line, they know how to run the football, and they're committed to running the football today.
Jackson State keeping it on the ground, getting closer. That was Zach Herring, a sophomore fullback from Tunica, Mississippi. Marcus down on the field and whistles come out.
Yeah, and this is a big penalty if it's against Jackson State, because it'll move them back 5 yards.
It is against the Tigers.
Yeah, and what they were trying to do, they were trying to get a hurry-up play because Alcorn State was trying to make defensive substitutions, so they thought they could come with a quick snap, but you see the left tight end, it's the guy that jumped off field, and Trey Rutland is upset because he knew that they had him. They had the wrong personnel on the field for Alcorn State. If they could have got that quick snap going, they probably would have scored a touchdown.
Jackson State's play selection, 19 rush, passing 6, total of 25. A number of those have been improvised by Rutland, who is rolling left, has a man open, who makes a nice diving grab. That's Edward Lee, the fullback from Sunflower, Mississippi.
Jackson State can still get a first down here. Trey Rutland rolling out to his left, pass a little high. This is a great job by Edward Lee.
Went up and got an alley-oop.
Yeah, and he's a fullback. He goes 6 feet, 240, so he's not used to stretching and making those type of pass receptions. Fourth down play for here, and Jackson State's going to go for it with a 4th-and-1 on the 1.5-yard line.
Heron in the backfield along with Edwards. Once again, Marcus down on the field. There was movement along the interior. It's a matter of who moved first.
Yeah, can't have those type of mistakes if you're Alcorn. They get the penalty, and of course, that half the distance will give Jackson State the 1st-and-goal.
So Jackson State now from point blank range. Touchdown, Edward Lee, the big sophomore fullback.
I tell you what, after that big catch he had on 3rd down, I think you deserve to give him a chance to run it in for the touchdown. Only 3 rushing attempts all year and his 1st touchdown in his football season.
Well, they're celebrating right now in Sunflower.
You know where Sunflower is?
It's a beautiful part of this state, I'm sure. On for the extra point, Eric Perry. He's an all-conference kicker. And Alcorn State is now on the board. The pride of Sunflower punches it into the end zone. Jackson State now leading Alcorn State 14-0, with all due respect to Jackson State. I said Alcorn State was on the board, but maybe spiritually, but haven't gotten there yet. 10 plays, 75-yard drives. Remember, this started with that blocked kick, and Jackson State takes advantage of it, and the Tigers now lead it 14-0. 4:46 remaining before halftime here at Memorial Stadium, the Capital City Classic on ESPNU. On the kickoff, Alcorn State tries to pull one out of its back pocket. Doesn't really go too far. That's Joshua Brumfield, the running back on the receiving end of it. But defensively, Jackson State was not fooled. Mitchell Mootson was there defensively. So Alcorn State will try and get it going when we get back.
It's time to unleash your inner Santa. Head to Santa's Other Workshop, the Home Depot, the one place with everything you need to make your home festive, inside and out, all at guaranteed low prices, now even lower. Bring the holidays home for less at the Home Depot.
I'm poolside with John Graham, MVP.
PG, see it in 3D now.
You're watching ESPNU College Football presented by Allstate. It's the Capital City Classic from Jackson, Mississippi. Fans of all ages enjoying this one. Alcorn State, after giving up another touchdown, begins its offensive set. And flags fly, whistles come out.
Start on the offense, number 72, 5.
Here's Bergwood on location, brought to you by Allstate. 63rd meeting between these two schools. Named the Capital City Classic in 1992. Jackson State leads the overall series. Alcorn State has won four of the last five. Intercepted! Touchdown! Ryan Rich comes up with six. So now the defensive unit for Jackson State has gotten in on the action.
And this Jackson State defense, they have been great all year long, not giving up any points, but also the interception for a touchdown. And we'll have to settle down number 7, Timothy Buckley, the quarterback for Alcorn State, but just a great play by Ryan Rich, number 14. He already had one ball that he tipped up in the air that caused an interception, and now he gets the interception himself and takes it in for the touchdown.
19 yards on the play. Extra point is up and good. So Jackson State beginning to flex its muscles here late in the second quarter.
Now you can see Tim Buckley trying to throw the out route and the wide receiver slips, but just a great break by number 14, Ryan Rich, and he knows how to find the end zone. Once the receiver falls down, there's nothing that can be done, and Rich is right there. Johnny on the spot taking advantage and gives Jackson State a 21-0 lead. 19-yard interception return. Second interception today for the Tigers. So the defense, they're winning the turnover battle, something that Alcorn had to prevent. I mean, they had to control the clock and also control the turnovers. Already two interceptions for the day, one return for a touchdown.
Not a bad day at all so far for Rich. Two interceptions. When it's going right. Defensive coordinator Darren Hayes has to be very pleased with what's going on right now. Jackson State's defensive unit is the number one total defense in the SWAC and number one against the pass. And you just saw why.
Yeah, I mean, they have 34 sacks on the year. I mean, Marcus Bernard has 14 by himself. We only had 8 interceptions, so not a high number of interceptions, but they get 2 today and one return for a touchdown. It seems poised and ready for that SWAC championship game December 13th.
On the kickoff, on the return, there is some room. down the far sideline for McLaurin, but he's quickly ushered out of bounds. Words exchanged, as they always are in games like this. Officials doing a good job separating the young men. But that happens in a game like this. .421 remaining in the first half. Coming up, rivalry weekend. Buckeyes doing it to Michigan. No surprise there. In the Big 12 preview, what a heck of a year it's been for that conference, especially its quarterbacks and offenses. ESPNU Sports Center coming up at halftime. So, can Alcorn State get anything going on this drive? Taking over at the 33-yard line. They elect to keep it on the ground.
I think if you're Alcorn, you still have to run your full allotment of plays. You can't panic and just start passing the ball every down. This Jackson State defense is too good. You still have enough time to score in this half by running and throwing the football.
Brumfield with an 8-yard pickup gets the ball down to the 41-yard line. And Eddie, in this situation, you, as best you can, you try and convince your players, let's get it back in increments, yeah, not all at once.
The first thing you tell them is don't panic. Everybody just take a deep breath and keep playing football. Keep playing hard. Good things will happen.
Brumfield still on the ground. Gets back to maybe the original line of scrimmage. And that'll bring up third down.
See, if you look at guys like Marcus Bernard and also Sam Washington on this Jackson State defense, they have too many good pass rushers for you to just sit up here and try to throw the football every play. You still have to run in, you put in your runs and your passes, a little play action, and just take it one step at a time. Get one touchdown, and at that point, you can get back into the ball game.
Third and three, loss of one on the play. Ball at the 40-yard line. Alcorn State trailing this one 21-0. Man in motion is Channing Pugh. Miscue on the snap. And Buckley just has to cover the ball and go down for his life. Larry Dennis, number 95, was there.
Tell you what, don't question Buckley's toughness, because this ball is on the ground and he tries to pick it up and make something happen. And as soon as he turns around, number 95, Larry Dennis, all 285 pounds, gets a free shot on number 7, the quarterback. And this Jackson State defense is on fire.
Loss of 7 on the play, brings on the punting unit. That will take an Alcorn State bounce. So Jackson State will take over inside. It's on 20-yard line, leading 21-0 with 2 minutes, 10 seconds remaining before halftime. We are close to the end of the season, and the awards are coming out. So the first of the E-Rob Awards come out. And who's your player of the year?
Well, we have to go with Brian Lee, of course. I mean, this guy has been sensational all year for the Southern Jaguars, has put up a lot of points, and they still have a chance, if they can beat Grambling, to get into the SWAC championship game. So you never know.
He's one of the most exciting players. We saw him earlier in the year. It's amazing the different things he can do.
Yeah, I mean, and guy is not a really big guy, but he's a great runner as well as a passer. He really makes that whole offense go.
Now, was it hard for you just to come up with him, because there's some exciting players in this conference?
Now, he's been pretty much the top of the class from an offensive perspective.
Rutland on the carry. Let's take a look at the Eddie Robinson selection. Those numbers are very impressive.
Now, you look at 300 yards per game of total offense, and I think the biggest thing with Brian Lee is his touchdown to interception ratio. The kid makes very few mistakes. He always seems to put the Jaguars in a very good play, a good positive play, and makes great decisions with the football.
Rutland out of the shotgun. Miscommunication with his receiver, because Keenan Tillman, number 88, simply stopped running his route, and Rutland obviously thought he was going deeper.
Big third down play here for Alcorn State. Of course, if you can stop them now, you have a chance to come back with Tim Buckley and run your 2-minute offense. Maybe get you a score before the half. If you're Jackson State, right now, if you can convert this first down, you can put more points on the board. So definitely the pressure is on Alcorn State defense since they're down 21-0.
Third and 6, ball at the 34. That's caught, but it probably is going to be shy of the first down. Carlos Simpson with the reception.
Timeout on the field.
Very close. A generous spot could get them the first down, but I think it would have to be pretty generous.
Mississippi's number one Cadillac dealer, Barksdale Cadillac.
Jacksonville State scored on the opening drive of this game, then took advantage of miscues by Alcorn State, scored after a blocked kick, and then the interception pick six by Ryan Rich.
Well, early on, Alcorn State, I mean, they had a couple turnovers by Jackson State. They also blocked the punt, got them the ball deep in their territory, and just an inch short.
So just an inch. Ernest Jones looking on in his first year at Alcorn State. Very accomplished assistant coach. Stops at Cincinnati, among others. He's committed to rebuilding the program here at his alma mater. A lot of passion and belief about what he can get done.
Yeah, he's a very enthused young coach, and you like that. You like the guy that can really relate to the players. And you know, he's a played wide receiver here at Alcorn, of course, in that Steve McNair era when they were throwing the ball around and doing a lot of great things. But he came up through the coaching ranks as a defensive back and also a defensive coordinator. He said, hey, I know the offensive side of the ball. Let me learn what's going on defense. And I think he's the right man for this Alcorn State job to really get this program to play at that high level, you know, when they had the Steve McNair's here.
Told us earlier in the week when we chatted with him that he actually thought he was just a few good players away from actually getting it going. And that's where recruiting comes in. Fourth and one. Rutland stepped back, something he did not like when he looked at the defensive setup for Alcorn State, so he wants to talk to Rick Comagie, his head coach, and the offensive coordinator, James Woody. Make sure he makes the right move.
Yeah, I think in that situation, you're just trying to draw him offside. It's not the prudent thing to do is put your punt team on here. With that great defensive 21-0 lead, you don't have to take a chance and press, try to get another first down and score more points before the half if you're Jackson State. We'll see.
Rick Comagie in his third year, we mentioned, the reigning SWAC Coach of the Year. Done a really good job. Really good job.
Yeah, I mean, the year before he got here, I mean, the Jackson State program was really down. I mean, they had a losing season, something that just doesn't happen around here. Another fourth down attempt looks like they're going to go for it.
Rutland keeps it. Forward momentum should get the first down and move the chains. First and 10 for Jackson State. Rutland looking to throw. Going downfield. And it's very nearly picked off. Tomasi Fuller. The junior transfer from Arizona Western Community College was actually the closest receiver to the ball.
Yeah, but I like the play call. I like the fact that they took a shot going up top. You never know, you can get a big play. And wide receiver had to turn into defensive back because Tomasi Fuller had great position. Almost had a chance to pick this football off.
Carlos Everett was the closest Jackson State receiver to the ball, but it was Fuller, who already has two interceptions, had a shot at his third. Whistles and flags are down.
False start. Offense, number 77, 5-yard penalty. Replay. Second down.
And that's Michael Smith, who is one of the upperclassmen on this team, a senior, and you just don't expect that.
Yeah, you know, we talked with Coach Comagie about this football game yesterday, and of course we tried to ask him, you know, who do you want to play in the SWAC championship game, and you know, coaches would never give you that answer, but he realized the importance of this game, you know, first of all to his team and then also to the fans. I mean, this Capital City Classic is huge around here, and they want to beat Alcorn no matter what the record is, if you win the SWAC or not.
Rutland under pressure, he's going down. Javelli Fields freshman from Grand Prairie, Texas, with the sack.
I tell you what, now this may give Alcorn State a chance to get something going on offense. If they can force Jackson State into a punting situation because of the big sack on that play, now they're in the aggressive mode. Trey Rutland did the smart thing. I mean, when you pressure, the offensive line lets you down, no one is open downfield, hey, you're up 21-0. It's not always a bad situation when you take a sack.
ESPNU.com is your gateway to all college sports content from ESPN, combining the latest news with an expanded collection of exclusive material, scores, columns, video and audio highlights, podcasts, live streaming games, and much more. Log on to ESPNU.com today. It is 21-0 here in Jackson, Mississippi, but Eddie, defensively, Alcorn State has not been that bad.
No, they haven't. I mean, they've been playing pretty good. Of course, they have been. They had the one big run early on that gave them about 40 or 50 yards. But besides that, I mean, they 14 points on the defense. Another one was an interception for a touchdown by Jackson State defense. So all in all, the Alcorn State Braves have been playing pretty good defense, although the score doesn't reflect that.
One of those scores, of course, a defensive score for Jackson State.
Now keep in mind, Alcorn State almost blocked the punt earlier. They forced the punter to pull it down and have to run with it. So we'll see if they can bring pressure once again to the Jackson State punt formation and maybe to block this punt or force them to try to run it again like they did last time.
Brett Bennett will drop back to punt, awaiting the punt. Corey McLaurin, who's standing at his own 39-yard line. 36 seconds remaining before halftime. McLaurin will not field it, but Alcorn State will get the ball. 45-yard line or so. Not bad field position. A couple of shots at the end zone.
Yeah, I think you have to take a couple shots. I mean, you're down 21-0. You still have one timeout left. You have an excellent field goal kicker also. So even if you can't get a touchdown, maybe you can get in the field goal range and put 3 points on the board.
Is Tim Buckley right now just a little gun shy? A couple of interceptions.
Yeah, I think that last interception for a touchdown was the one that really got him. The other one was just a great defensive play by Jackson State. But the last one maybe was just a miscommunication between him and the wide receiver, and it was a touchdown. I mean, an interception that returned for a touchdown. So he just needs to settle down, realize it's another football game, go out there and have fun and complete a couple passes, get some first downs.
Buckley. Under pressure, it's running. He picks up a first down. Taylor Richardson, hopeful he'll get a shot at it. One of the better field goal kickers in the conference. Buckley under pressure again. This time releases out of the backfield to Pilcher, who was tracked down and stopped by Ryan Rich, who's just having a whale of a game.
Yeah, Ryan Rich, an interception for a touchdown. He's made a couple of tackles today and just had a great defensive first half for a cornerback.
That will close the first two quarters of the 2008 Capital City Classic. Jackson State leading Alcorn State 21-0 here in Jackson, Mississippi. SportsCenterU studio coming up.
Welcome. Gave Purdue a little bit of motivation there.
You were looking in at the Sonic Boom of the South. It is the marching band for Jackson State. They're working it. You got the second half coming up after the break on the U.
76.
Halftime of the Capital City Classic, Jackson State leading Alcorn State 21-0 here in Jackson, Mississippi.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back inside Memorial Stadium along with my partner, Eddie Robinson Jr. I'm Dwayne Ballin. Are you surprised at the first half, the way it went?
Well, it was a very exciting first half. Alcorn State, they had the opportunities to make some big things happen. They just couldn't take advantage of the breaks that were given to them.
And Jackson State did what it needed to do, some big plays.
Yeah, Jackson State, they're doing just enough. I mean, these guys are poised to go into that SWAC championship game. They're playing very well. They took advantage of the opportunities. They blocked the field goal, then they scored on the touchdown, scored on the pick six. So they're playing well defensively, and that's what we expected.
And back to Alcorn State, mistakes. They had opportunities, but they've made mistakes.
Yeah, absolutely. The mistakes have been the problem. Here you see Timothy Buckley not realizing that he should just throw it away in the end zone. The ball is tipped into the air, and Ryan Ridge gets his first interception on the day. That was a big mistake by the quarterback. Here you see he throws to a wide open receiver on the third down conversion. He bobbles it, and of course, the outstanding linebacker speaks, makes him pay. Then you come back with a blocked field goal that they were in chip shot range for, and Marcellus Speaks gets that block. And lastly, Timothy Buckley is coming with the interception for a touchdown once again by Ryan Rich.
The interesting thing is, as we take a look at our first half stats brought to you by Samsung, as we look at these numbers, Alcorn State, as we noted, has had opportunities and defensively hasn't really played that poorly.
Yeah, their defense has played pretty well. I mean, the 21-0 wouldn't indicate that, but they've stopped Jackson State. I mean, they slowed down that running attack, but unfortunately, the interception for a touchdown and then also the blocked field goal is what really has hurt Alcorn State today.
We're at halftime, the Capital City Classic, Jackson State leading Alcorn State 21-0.
It's very rare. The internet says there's 10 of them left.
Let's ask our experts.
Looks like a cat.
Looks like a panther.
Speaking of the Panthers, what are we like in the NFC South this year?
Well, historically, the bottom team one year wins it the next.
That's great news for the Falcons.
Tune into the best team in football. Sunday NFL Countdown presented by IBM, Sundays at 11.
He's not afraid to attack tough issues.
Do you really want to be number one this week? You're better off laying in the woods at about number 11.
He's not afraid to state his mind.
Never hire the...
Jackson State leading Alcorn State 21-0, Rivalry Week here on ESPNU. Here are today's impact players brought to you by Taco Bell. An update on the way they are going. Not too bad.
No, Lee Robinson, I mean, this guy has 100 tackles already on the year, 6 tackles, and 1 for loss, a sack, and a forced fumble. But on the other side, Trey Rutland has been playing a very consistent game. 8 of 10 from completion, had a couple good rushes, also a rushing touchdown, and is not making any mistakes. He hasn't thrown an interception in the past 5 games. He's been the difference, the resurgence of this Jackson State team.
If you're Alcorn State and Ernest Jones, how do you approach this second half? It's not over. It may be difficult, but it's not over.
Well, it's not over at all, and I think you're going to give yourself some opportunities in this football game just by scoring on this opening drive. You still can run all of your plays. Run your passes. You did a good job running the football in the first half against Jackson State. Just try to score one touchdown and don't win the game on this first drive.
We're underway in the third quarter. Opening kickoff is bobbled, but Jackson State does not get the recovery. Alcorn State will maintain possession. Avery Williams is the man who recovered it and jumped on it. So Alcorn State will have the opportunity to strike first in this second half. Tough first half for the Braves. We'll see Timothy Buckley, or will we? Coming out on the field is number 6. That's Tony Hobson, the backup quarterback. And this is maybe the first indication that Ernest Jones wants to really shake things up in the second half. Hobson, a senior from Jackson, and he'll open up the quarterback. The markers are down as Alcorn State elects to go on the ground for the opening play of the second half. So, Ernest Jones has made the decision that Tony Hobson needs to come in and try and jumpstart this offense.
Holding. On it. Number 77, 10 yards from the replay, first down.
That's Matthew Hooper, senior from New Orleans.
Well, I think you definitely need a spark, so I think this may be a good decision to put Tony Hobson in, but I wouldn't be surprised if Timothy Buckley doesn't get back in the football game at some point. He's definitely the guy long-term that they feel like is the leader of this Alcorn State offense.
So it's first and 20 after the penalty. Hobson calls his on number over the left side. Doesn't get too far before he's corralled and brought down by Marcellus Spinks. Came into this, we noted at the top of the telecast, leading the SWAT with 106 total tackles and 10 tackles and 1.5 sacks last week. He's been active all day today. Rumfield gets out over the 30-yard line. This is probably not the way to get back into it, or is it?
Well, I think this is the way to get back into the game. You just have to keep running your plays. I mean, they had did a good job of running the football early in the first and second quarter. Yeah, I don't think you can get into a situation where you're passing every down against this talented Jackson State defense. Now, you say Tony Hobson, his strengths, he has a stronger arm than Buckley. He's probably more of a pure passer, not as good of a runner as Buckley, so this third down situation may be to his advantage.
Third and 13. That's an interesting third down call.
Very good.
When you're down
call.
21-0, and you bring in a new quarterback who has a stronger arm.
I mean, you have to give him a chance to throw the football. I mean, you're not going to complete or convert many third and 13 plays against this Jackson State defense. I can guarantee you that.
Well, that will bring on the punter, Alex Elfke. Michael Mouton, number 83, is back to receive the punt for Jackson State. Elfke's punt is fielded at the 30-yard line by Mouton, and he doesn't get very far before he slips and is down. So Jackson State's offensive unit will take the field for the first time in this second half here at the Capital City Classic. Offensive coordinator James Woody talking to Trey Rutland and crew before they take the field.
Yeah, I talk with offensive coordinator for Jackson State, and he really likes Trey Rutland. He likes the fact that this is a guy that really goes through his progressions. He's really progressing as a quarterback week to week. You know, his transformation over the first five games to the last five has been very good, and they feel like his best football is ahead of him. They think next year he's going to be a very good quarterback in the SWAT.
Mosley is now the quarterback for Jackson State, and his first play is a pass. It's a completion. So Woody and Kamaji decide to go with another quarterback.
Yeah, that's somewhat of a surprise because Trey Rutland's been playing pretty good in the first half. I don't know if that's caused by injury or they just want to put a different quarterback in. That's an interesting call.
Mosley, 261 yards and 3 touchdowns passing so far this year prior to that play. Junior from New Orleans. Pickup of 8 on the play after the reception by Simpson. It's time they go on the ground, and Edwards is very near a first down. A generous spot would get it for him.
Now, Mosley has played quite a bit this season. At one point, they were going back and forth between Mosley and Trey Rutland. Both quarterbacks were struggling. And after that fifth game, once Trey Rutland really realized that, you know, I can do things outside of the pocket, you know, he went from not throwing any of the interceptions. And Mosley and Rutland are very good friends off the field. So they have a very, you know, competitive rivalry, but they both encourage each other to play well.
That was good for a first down. So now with the ball at the 41-yard line, Mosley out of the shotgun, has a receiver, crossing pattern, has a first down, still on his feet. And that's Keenan Tillman, a freshman from Milton, Florida, with a big pickup for the first down. Malcolm Taylor finally with the tackle.
Yeah, look at Mosley. He stands in the pocket, good protection, and connects on that slant route, and once the safety misses that tackle, man, you have a big opportunity by a very big receiver to get some yards after the catch.
Jackson State now into territory of Alcorn State. Mosley again looking to throw, has another man open, another big pickup. It's Tillman again.
That pass
and he's down to the 12-yard line.
negative 17.
So right now, it's Mosley to Tillman.
Yeah, same play. You can see the linebacker, number 56, Lee Robinson. He's trying to find the receiver, but he doesn't get deep enough. And they're running that cover, too. Of course, the hole in that is right in the middle of the field, in between the hashes, over the linebacker's head.
A 19-yard pickup, couple of receptions, 54 yards for Tillman. It's first down. Very little on the ground as Mosley decides to keep it. He's a bit leaner than Trey Rutland. Both are 6'3". He weighs 225. Rutland listed at 239.
Now, Trey Rutland, he was banged up a couple weeks ago and had to come out of the football game and allow Mosley to play in the second half because he had a nagging shoulder injury. So I don't know if it's a matter of that shoulder injury is bothering Trey Rutland or they just wanted to let Mosley get in the game and get some work. But I tell you what, it's been a very good move for the Tigers. He's moving them down the field.
Pickup of two, ball down at the 15-yard line of Alcorn State. Edwards really doesn't get anywhere. Lee Robinson was on top of him.
Yeah, Lee Robinson has been as advertised today. Already had six tackles and a sack and the forced fumble early on in this football game, all in the first half. And he's the heart and soul of this Alcorn State defense. Guy plays with a lot of pride. And coach described him just as a good old country boy. He said, you give him a fishing pole and just let him go, and he has a good time. But this guy's a very good football player and a very good student athlete off the field also. You always like to see that.
Animal science major who wants to be a veterinarian.
He said he's an avid hunter, so I didn't understand that.
I didn't understand that either. Pass incomplete. But you're right. Lee Robinson is an outstanding student, this fine linebacker for Alcorn State, number 56, at 3.0 GPA. Veterinarian he wants to be, but he loves to hunt and fish.
Yeah, no safety in the middle of the field, just trying to catch Carlos Simpson. Going up the seam. Good defensive play by Alcorn State.
Eric Perry comes on for the attempted field goal. Yards out, and he's good. He is now 7 for 7 from that distance. Eric Perry adds three more on to the Jackson State total.
He's not afraid to attack tough issues.
Do you really want to?
Oh, no.
I told you guys, under a minute.
Today's college football game on ESPNU is presented in high definition. Jackson State with the 34-yard field goal from Eric Perry now leads it 24-0, opening moments of the third quarter here in Jackson, Mississippi, along with Eddie Robinson Jr. and our entire ESPNU crew. I'm Dwayne Ballin. It's the Capital City Classic, 63rd meeting between these two fine institutions. It's Rivalry Week on ESPNU.
Alcorn State, they're still looking for that big play out of their offense. They haven't had that yet today. They tried to change quarterbacks. We'll see what quarterback they go with on this drive.
Joshua Corey McLaren fields the kickoff. Gets the return back down to the 24-yard line. See Tony Hobson, who was in on the last series, the backup senior from Jackson, is taking the field once again. So, Coach Robinson, the thinking here. We talked about it on the last series, try and get something going, but Hobson really didn't have an opportunity to showcase that strong arm. Markers are down as he was operating out of the shotgun. Tim Buckley will have to be relegated to the role of spectator. It's been a very frustrating day for Coach Ernest Jones so far.
Well, you're talking about a coach that took this job and said, my number one priority is to beat Jackson State. Whoa, bad snap.
Bad snap. Hobson is running for his life, and he goes down at the 1-yard line. Jackson State's defensive units just teeing off on the Braves.
Seven down.
Ryan Rich was one of the first men to get to him.
Yeah, and you're really just not giving yourself a chance to compete in that situation. If you're Alcorn State, you're just making way too many mistakes. And quite honestly, you're not a good enough team to make those type of mistakes against a Jackson State team that's headed to the SWAC championship game for the second time in a row.
Loss of 19 yards. It is now second down and 34. They catch Brumfield in the end zone. That's going to be a safety. They called him in the grasp. So everything's going right now for Jackson State and going wrong for Ernest Jones and Alcorn State.
Yeah, it's one of those things where you just scratch your head as a head coach and like, man, can we get a do-over? Can we start this game over?
Marcus Jamison, number 19, was the man to get to him. Jackson State's defensive unit finding different ways to score against its rival. Alcorn State practicing the shotgun snap, had problems with it on the last series, and it ended up leading to a safety for Jackson State. When it's going wrong, Eddie.
Well, I tell you what, sometimes you just have those days at the office, and, you know, Coach Jones, he's been around coaching for quite some time and the former player here at Alcorn, he'll get the Braves going again, and you just have to realize it's part of the growing process. You have a lot of young players, you're new to the program, and just one of those things you have to go through in order to get to that final spot that you want to be.
Alcorn State, a punt away to Jackson State. Return out to the sideline. That's Mouton. ESPNU delivers ACC college football action later today as the Duke Blue Devils head to Blacksburg to take on Frank Beamer's Virginia Tech Hokies. College football primetime presented by Citi on ESPNU and ESPNU HD today at 5:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. Already a mild surprise in the ACC as North Carolina State knocked off North Carolina at Chapel Hill. There's a look at Trey Rutland, who played the entire first half, the starter, and now has given way to his backup, Michael Mosley. First and 10 from the 45-yard line. Jackson State with the ball and very much in control. Marker comes down on the field. Play clock might have run out. Rivalry week on ESPN, and this usually is one of the best ones in the country, but facts are facts, and Jackson State is on a roll. Rick Comegy has them coming into this game with five straight victories, and Alcorn State has lost four straight and is rebuilding. And that bears itself out in what we're seeing. Mosley out of the shotgun, going deep. Defensively there was Tomasi Fuller. The intended receiver was Brian Jackson.
I tell you, one thing you notice when Michael Mosley has come into the football game, they've been taking a couple shots deep since he's entered, and it seemed like Tomasi Fuller has been the guy that's been the target of most of the Jackson State wide receivers, but he's been up to the task so far. There's, of course, starting quarterback Trey Rutland, and I'm just guessing, but I'm pretty sure that they're just taking him out from more of a precaution standpoint. He did have a minor injury with that shoulder a couple weeks ago, and just trying to make sure he's ready for that SWAC championship game.
Second and 15, Mosley. This time the blitz is coming. He gets it away. And nowhere near a white-shirted player. The closest man was Corey McLaurin, but number 22 is wearing a dark jersey. You're right, they're taking shots downfield. So far, they're not connecting.
Yeah, but I tell you what, this does help Alcorn State. Of course, that clock is stopped now, and you have two incomplete passes. So I mean, for the Alcorn State faithful or looking at comeback opportunities, I mean, they're at least giving you a chance to, you know, get three incomplete passes, get your offense back on the field and make something happen in the ball game.
Third and 15 for Jackson State. Tigers wearing white. Alcorn State in the dark uniforms. Mosley, quick release to a man out of the backfield. That's Gerard Smith, sophomore running back from right here in Jackson. Pickup of five, but it will bring on the punting unit. Fourth down and 10. So Brett Bennett, who's had some interesting moments on the field so far this afternoon, will kick away to Corey McLaurin. This one's blocked.
You can pick it up. Scoop and score.
Alcorn State. The ball was loose, and it eventually is recovered. We're waiting for the officials to pull everyone apart. So Alcorn State will have an opportunity to begin its offensive set deep into Jackson State territory.
But I tell you what, Dwayne, I think that's...
Special teams coming through for Alcorn State. We'll see if it pays dividends when we return to Jackson.
Does bundling really say
DirecTV? This is ESPN Rivalry Week, presented by Samsung Mobile.
Welcome back to Jackson. Tim Buckley, number 7, has returned in to quarterback for Alcorn State after being replaced by Tony Hobson. First and 10 from the 12-yard line. Brumfield breaks up the middle, gets out across the 5, ball's loose on the field. And fortunately for Alcorn State, Elliott Moore, number 8, jumps on it for the recovery.
Let's take a look at that block punt again. And the thing about this, it's a great job of blocking the punt, but honestly, it should be a touchdown. If we freeze frame it right here, it's a good 5 yards between the next defender and the Alcorn State players. There's two of them. One of them needs to pick up the football and get it into the end zone. It's great that you did block the punt, but when you're down 26-0, you need 7 points right now.
Pickup of 7 on the last run by Brumfield is 2nd and 3. Pilcher, right side, stacked up.
Pilcher on the carry down the 3-yard line. Third down for Bray.
Well, the running game has been a surprise for Alcorn State today, but it's going to be really tough to run across the goal line on this Jackson State defense. This front 7, they take a lot of pride in stopping the run. And I tell you what, it's going to be a hard go for the Braves to just say we're going to pound it in there and not try to go into the, not try to throw the ball into the end zone.
Pickup of 2 on the last play. It is now 3rd and 1. Alcorn State desperately needs 6 points. Pilcher stacked up and dropped. What a job by Carlos Meeks, number 41, the junior from right here in Jackson. That's a loss of 3 yards.
Look at that guy right there. Now, what he's going to do is penetrate right here and destroy this fullback, and that's what causes this play not to work at all. Yes, the linebacker, the outside linebacker, number 41, he does a great job of just destroying the fullback and making the play, and that's why Jackson State leads the FCS in tackles for loss. Individual efforts by players like Meeks.
It's amazing. The tackles for loss is just staggering what this team could do. As a matter of fact, Bernard and Speaks are 1 and 2 respectively in the entire conference in that category.
Yeah, but the big thing on that one, I mean, look at these guys. Tackle for loss, 1st in the FCS. Total yards allowed, they're 2nd. Sacks, they're 4th. Of course, Bernard has 14 sacks by himself. And the biggest thing, the most important category, points allowed, they're only giving up 18.6 points per game. Of course, they're pitching a shutout today.
look at Meeks, who made the big play. 6'3", 245 pound. Came in from Hines Community College. So Taylor Richardson, number 47 for Alcorn State, is set to come out to attempt a 23-yard field goal. He is 4 of 6 from that distance this season. The last one was blocked. The kick was blocked, and that led to a drive downfield and a touchdown.
But now they're putting the quarterback back on the field with the offense, which I think is a good move. I don't think a field goal really gives you a whole lot of hope to win the football game. You have to have an attitude with your team. Hey, we're going to try to win this game. It is a building block for next year, if nothing else.
And the quarterback, again, is Tim Buckley, who has been reinserted into the starting lineup.
They have a free play.
Touchdown, Alcorn State, if it stands.
There is a flag down. We'll see who the call is on.
Emmanuel Arsenal.
Jackson State players are symbolizing that there's a hold, that there was a flag before the play started, which is usually offside.
There's a lot of lobbying going on down on the field on the part of the players. Wait to hear from George McCollum. Penalty is declined. It was against Jackson State. So Alcorn State finally does get on the board here in the 2008 Capital City Classic.
And I just like this call because it's a very aggressive call. You let your quarterback get a run pass option, and he does a great job of finding a receiver in the back of the end zone.
Extra point from Elfke is good. So it's now 26-7. Jackson State leading Alcorn State. Let's join Lowell Galindo in the studio for our SportsCenter U in-game update. Penn State looking mighty good against Michigan State. They're probably kicking themselves about that game in Iowa.
Yeah, you can't take back that one loss. It's still on the record. That big one is sitting there.
Joe Pa, a lot of people very happy for the 82-year-old coach getting his team back into the upper echelon of college football. 800th all-time victory. Penn State, what a program. Question, of course, is what's going to happen after this season? Of course, Paterno doesn't want to discuss that. Here in Jackson, Mississippi, we're at the Capital City Classic. Eddie Robinson Jr., our entire ESPNU crew. I'm Dwayne Ballin. And these two rivals have been going at it 63 times. Alcorn State getting on the board for the first time in the game. Kickoff to Jackson State. Time to check in on another of the E-Rob Award winners for the year, this time Defensive Player of the Year.
Well, I tell you what, it should be no surprise. You've been seeing this guy all over the field today. And, of course, that is Marcellus Speaks. I mean, he came into this year after a good campaign last year. He does it all. I mean, he loves to play the run. He can also drop back in coverage and intercept passes. A very physical, intense player. And one thing we did know, he actually blocked the field goal today also. This guy has 106 tackles, leads the SWAC, and 20 tackles for loss, leads the SWAC and the whole football championship subdivision. He's the leader of a very good Jackson State football team.
And you're certain that he and Bernard both will be playing on Sundays next fall?
I tell you what, they should get a shot. Dude. These guys are very talented.
His teammate Michael Mosley is still in at quarterback. We understand that Trey Rutland, the starter, is being held out. It's precautionary. You mentioned his shoulder that nags him, so he is the emergency quarterback should they need him. But Mosley's done a good job since he's been in.
Yeah, Mosley has done a good job, but I don't think you should take that this game isn't important for Jackson State or Coach Comegy and his staff. I mean, they realize the big picture is, of course, to win the SWAC, but for the faithful here, for the Jackson State alumni, they want to be Alcorn no matter what.
Ball at the 33-yard line. That's where Jackson State begins its offensive set. Edwards barreling his way up the middle. He is stopped by Malcolm Taylor. He's had a pretty good game so far.
Yeah, they have. I mean, Malcolm Taylor's had 2 sacks already today, has been putting a lot of pressure on the quarterback. And this Alcorn State defense, I mean, they're playing tough. I mean, this entire football game, they've been coming onto the field in bad situations, and they've kind of held their own against this Jackson State offense.
Really, if you look at it and really analyze it and break it down, they haven't really made major mistakes defensively. There have been some special teams, one or two things, but Alcorn State really has played fairly well on defense. Second and six. It was almost caught. Tillman and Mosley connected on a couple of big plays earlier, and this one was just a little behind.
That's a little behind. You can tell that the backup quarterback doesn't get as many throws in practice, and the timing is just a little off. Great attempt at trying to catch that football, but if he throws that in between the 88s, tell you what, that would be a first down for the Tigers.
Now, that pattern was on the opposite side of the field, but it's still the same pattern that those two connected on successfully on a previous scoring drive.
Yeah, they've been doing a great job running that skinny post route, and they're just going to the middle of the field, getting behind the linebacker in that two deep coverage zone at Alcorn State is playing.
It's third and six. Mosley, miscommunication with his receiver. Again, looking for Tillman. That'll bring the punting unit out for Jackson State, and Alcorn State can slowly work its way back into this. As you noted, it is not over.
Well, I mean, I really like that call that Coach Ernest Jones made on that fourth down play. It was fourth and goal, and you're down 26-0. I think you have to send a message to your kids that we're trying to win the football game, not just compete. And if you go for the field goal, you're really just trying to compete.
Brett Bennett gets his punt away. McLaurin is backed up at the 25-yard line, fields a punt. Gets out over the 35-yard line. And Alcorn State will come out.
I tell you what, it'll be interesting to see what they can do on offense right now. I won't say that the momentum has shifted to Alcorn, but it's probably back in the middle of the field right now. So I think both teams are playing with a lot of enthusiasm now.
We know that the Jackson State has already earned its way into the SWAC title game on the 13th of December, but the opponent is really up for grabs.
Yeah, we asked Coach Comegy, who would you like to play? Of course, coaches are never going to give you that answer. They lost to Grambling State 14-5 and Southern 35-28, so they know both of those teams very well.
Buckley still in at quarterback for Alcorn. Incomplete pass across the middle.
Of course, the wild card is the Prairie View Panthers. They didn't play Prairie View this year with the new SWAC scheduling, but they did lose to Prairie View last year on the road, so they know the Panthers well. And keep in mind, Prairie View is sitting there at 9-1, and they have a pretty good football team. It's hard to imagine a team can go 9-1 and don't get any type of postseason awards, no SWAC championship game or anything else.
Second down and 10. Buckley looking towards his receiver. Couldn't quite connect with Chris Williams. Back to the whole Western Division scenario. If Grambling State, who we're talking about, loses to Southern, then it's really interesting. If Grambling wins out, it's over. It's Grambling and Jackson State for the second straight year. But if they lose, what happens?
Well, if Grambling State loses, of course, then you have a three-way tie. With all of the tiebreakers, it's really no way to decide it except a coin toss among three people with a three-headed coin, from what I understand.
Buckley out of the shotgun on third down, under pressure, chucks it away, is running. One man to beat to get a first down. There's a marker down, so we'll have to wait and hear from George McCullum to find out exactly what happened. And if there is a three-way tie for that Western Division title, three different people will toss coins. The odd man out is gone. It's elimination.
So you don't like my idea of the three-headed coin? Nah, but seriously, yeah, you will have three people who will flip the coin simultaneously. And, of course, the odd person will get thrown out. Then the last two will then go back to the head-to-head competition rules.
Sounds like something that you did when you were 10 years old in the sandlot.
Well, we could pitch quarters to the line. That's what we did at 10 years old. But it's one of those things, of course, you always wanted to be decided on the field, but it's just one of those weird situations. Who would have thought that you can possibly have three teams all together in one conference in the West? Nobody thought that could actually happen.
Third and very long. Buckley under pressure, out of the shotgun. Gets it away. Man open and bobbles the ball. No one was around him. That was McLaurin, a senior from Collins, Mississippi. Had it No one around him.
Yeah, that still would have been well short of the first down. Just too many penalties on that drive. I mean, Buckley had the good run on third down, and, of course, the penalty brought it back. And in fourth, third and long situations, it's hard to convert against a good defense like Jackson State. And it's that same situation, Alcorn State, they've had their opportunities today, but they just haven't been able to make enough big plays on offense to really compete with this JSU Tiger defense.
Elfke now back to punt at his on 12-yard line. Mouton waiting at the 34. Indover end will take an Alcorn State bounce inside the 20-yard line, and that's where Jackson State will take over. Sunday, ESPNU brings you three college basketball games from the O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off. First at 10:30 a.m. Eastern, it's Fairfield and Chattanooga in the seventh place game. Then at 12:30 Eastern, Missouri faces number 20 Southern California in the fifth place game. And at 5 Eastern, Virginia Tech and Seton Hall meet in the third place game. The O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off on ESPNU Sunday. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. Of course, the number one team in the country, North Carolina, won last night. Tyler Hansbrough, the National Player of the Year, returned to action after that season-opening injury. First down, Jackson State keeping it on the ground. That's Edwards, and he is greeted by a couple of dark jerseys leading the way. Randy Carter, number 49.
I tell you what, if you coach Comegy going into that SWAC championship game, just looking ahead, you have to be concerned with your punt team, because they had two punts that were blocked. One the kicker couldn't get it off, and the next one was actually blocked. And that's something that you wouldn't expect at this time of the year, late in November, when your team has already played 10 ball games.
Alcorn State comes up with the defensive pressure and the touchdown. Just what the doctor ordered.
I tell you what, Lee Robinson, number 56, the all-everything middle linebacker for Alcorn State, the senior from Gloucester, Mississippi, always in the right place at the right time. He takes advantage of the mistake by Michael Mosley, puts another touchdown on the board. And I tell you what, Alcorn State, they're still in this football game. I think momentum has officially gone over to the Braves at this point.
And that was the person that we are not surprised would make that play. If Jackson State needed a big shot in the arm, or Alcorn State did, it would come from 56 Robinson. Extra point is good. And the Braves have not given up the fight.
Absolutely not. I mean, they're down by 12 points, and that was just a situation where Michael Mosley cannot throw this football. I mean, just take the sack right here, just go down. And you just throw it up for air, and that's an easy interception and a touchdown return for the talented linebacker, number 56, Lee Robinson.
Pressure being applied by JaVale Fields. So now the ball is beginning to bounce in the way of Alcorn State. And if you're Jackson State, if you're Rick Comegy and his offensive coordinator James Woody, are you thinking about putting Trey Rutland back in the game?
That's a tough call, because honestly, of course, the health of the kid is always their priority number one. And you have to realize, you were brought here, if you're Coach Comegy, to win the SWAC championships. You did that last year. Now you've won the East and you're in the SWAC championship game again. I mean, you have to kind of look at the long-term situation with Trey Rutland. But I tell you what, the JSU faithful want you to beat Alcorn State today. They don't really care about that SWAC championship game right now.
Rutland warming up on the sideline.
Exactly. That's what I'm talking about. They want you to win the game today, and I guess you have to go back with Rutland and just let him gut it out, and he'll be ready in 2 weeks.
Both teams, as you just saw, are able to capitalize on turnovers. Still on his feet, far sideline, down near the 40-yard line is Mouton.
And I tell you what really hurts when you look at that interception for a touchdown is that Trey Rutland hadn't thrown an interception in the last five games. So they were doing very good on offense, protecting the football. And with this type of defense that Jackson State have, really that's all you have to do. Just run the football well, make a couple big plays, and let your defense win the football game. Keep in mind that Jackson State defense has already scored 9 points with a touchdown return, interception return for a touchdown and a safety today.
Rutland is still in the role of special assistant. Mosley's going to come out onto the field.
Well,
but he has to probably produce on this series.
I would think so.
Mosley rolling out under pressure. Good defensive work by McLaurin on Edwards. There is a marker down on the field. Maybe McLaurin was, his coverage was too good. Call goes against Jackson State. Illegal receiver downfield.
Ineligible receiver. Downfield. Number 71. Penalty. Will be declined. Second down.
All of a sudden, I have to tell you, partner, it feels like Rick Comegy, like the ground's starting to shift underneath him a bit. Not quite as solid as it was in the first half.
Well, I tell you what, at one point they were up 26-0, and you're absolutely right. Things are not going their way, but this team is used to adversity. He talked about it yesterday. He feels like this team can overcome a couple of mistakes.
Great defensive work. Guess who? Lee Robinson says a big hello to Javard Smith.
Wow, just a great job of a linebacker reading and reacting. He splits it right between the cap and get a tackle for loss. 56, Lee Robinson has had a great game, a great career here at Alcorn State, and he is really showing up and showing out in his last Capital City Classic.
You're looking at a future veterinarian, folks.
Who likes hunting.
Now we
throw that in there also.
Trying to figure that one out. Third down, Mosley looking up top. Alcorn State defensively is getting it done. Jamison Smith, the junior defensive back from Madison, Mississippi, was there on the coverage.
I tell you what, if Alcorn State could just play defense the whole game, I think they could win this football game because their offense hasn't really given them anything, but the defense has scored on its own. It's set them up with the block punt, and you know, offensively they have to get one big play.
Bennett gets this one off. McLaurin fields it at the 21-yard line. And he's brought down by Ryan Rich. Alcorn State's defensive unit doing the job.
Yeah, great job against Trey Rutland the whole time. Malcolm Taylor, that was his first sack here. You see Malcolm Taylor coming around the horn again, just putting a lot of pressure on Trey Rutland. And once he leaves the game, in came the backup, Michael Mosley, and they corral him, and then the linebacker number 56, Lee Robinson, with the easy interception for a touchdown. And this Alcorn State defense has been playing very well today.
So Alcorn State, having scored the last 14 points of the game, gets it back. Buckley with time to throw, tucks it away, and is going to run. Smartly goes down before there is contact. There is a pep in his step. And Alcorn State, if you didn't know the score right now, looks to be the team in charge.
Yeah, they are. I mean, the momentum is definitely on their side. And I think what Buckley's going to have to do, he's going to have to use his legs. If no one is open downfield, he's a very good runner, and they're concerned about his running ability. He has to step up his game and take control of this football game.
Second and three. Buckley throws behind his receiver. That was Edward Johnson.
Big third down conversion for both teams here. Of course, if Alcorn State can get a couple of first downs and make something happen offensively, I think Buckley's going to be the guy. Maybe you can get him to roll out the pocket with a run pass option. He's so dangerous as a runner. You don't want him to just sit in the pocket and not have the opportunity to run the football.
Third and three. Buckley has his man, but I am not sure that Edward Johnson had enough for the first down. Of course, he appears to be short.
Yeah, and that's the job of the wide receiver, to make sure that you're across that first down marker. But Jackson State, the linebackers are there to put the immediate tackle. Well, they're moving the chains. They're not even going to measure.
They are giving him the first down. Boy, it looked mighty close.
Yeah, I think that was at least worth the measurement if you're Jackson State.
Well, it's going right for Alcorn State after so much went wrong in the first half.
I like the up-tempo, the hurry-up offense also by the Braves.
We're in the closing seconds of the third quarter of the Capital City Classic. Alcorn State in dark uniforms on the move. That's close to another first down. That's Emmanuel Arsenal on the reception. And that will be the final play of the third quarter. After trailing at halftime, 21-0, Alcorn State has found its footing, and the Braves are marching back into the Capital City Classic. Hang on, fourth quarter should be fun.
Saturday night.
Welcome back to Rivalry Week, presented by Samsung Mobile here in Jackson, Mississippi. The Capital City Classic, Jackson State leading Alcorn State 26-14 as we begin the fourth quarter. First play, Alcorn State. Pilcher keeps it on the ground. Not too much there. Let's return to the SportsCenter U studio and Lowell Galindo for SportsCenter U in-game update from the ACC.
Focusing on the ACC, it's Boston College and Wake Forest. Eagles with the ball, but Dominic Davis gets it up. Kevin Patterson recovers and scores the touchdown. That pulls Wake closer, but it's BC with a 13-7 lead in the second.
Wake Forest and Boston College battling to figure out, I guess, the Atlantic Division in the ACC. So many things can happen in that conference because it appears as though no one really wants to win it. Wake Forest needs that victory and needs a Maryland loss for it to win the ACC Atlantic. You talk about the three coin toss here in the SWAC. They may need an 8-coin toss in the ACC to figure out who gets to their championship game.
I tell you what, all of the parity in the different conferences, you're going to have to really hone in on the new tiebreaker policy. You're going to have to go to point differentials or something, because right now you never know how this thing could end up at the end of the year with all of these teams that are pretty much evenly.
First and 10 for the 48-yard line of Alcorn State. Braves have gotten right back into this one as we are opening up the fourth quarter. In and out of the hands of his intended receiver, Marquise McFarland. A freshman from Hattiesburg had it and a sure first down.
Yeah, I think he was just thinking about running after the catch. You just have to relax and look at all the way in. He was wide open. Good route, good throw. Probably his best of the day by number 7, Timothy Buckley, and the freshman just couldn't hold on.
Buckley's frustration showed on that. So now it's second down. Again, a reminder, folks, it was Jackson State big, 21-0 at halftime. Alcorn State has really climbed back into this one. Flags down, more flags come down. Buckley goes down. There may have been three different infractions on that play.
Well, I think every referee has thrown the flag and
their hats down.
Yeah, his hat's on the ground.
Let's just say something went wrong on the play.
I tell you what, it's gonna be tough sorting this out because everybody has a different penalty. Like, hey, I want mine to be the one you call.
Ernest Jones calmly watching in his first year. Head coach at his alma mater, a member of that 1994 SWAC championship team, told us it's not easy watching your alma mater struggle. Best thing to do is to get in, participate, and get the ship righted.
Yeah, it's even harder when you're the head coach. But, I mean, I think he'll get the Braves going in the right direction. Good, young, energetic coach, has some good assistants, and says he's just around 5 or 10 impact players away from really competing in the SWAC. And if you look at Alcorn State this year, the only games that they really weren't competitive in was Grambling State early on, and then the last game right before this one was against Prairie View. Other than that, they were within a touchdown of everyone else that they played within the conference.
He told us he knew it would be difficult this first year. I think maybe a little more difficult than he realized.
Is
referee George McCollum.
We have three fouls on the play.
Wow.
Holding on Alcorn, 66, will enforce a 10-yard penalty. We have two personal fouls on Jackson State. Will only force one, 15 yards, automatic first down.
So it's a plus five for Alcorn?
Yeah, I tell you what, it really benefited the Braves. And more importantly, it's a first down for the Alcorn State Braves as they try to get back into this football game.
McCollum and the officiating crew did a very good job.
They did an excellent job of sorting
everything out.
They were taking notes and writing down cheat sheets and trying to figure out who did what, but they did a good job of getting it right. And that's what's most important. Let the kids play the game.
So here we are, 13:43 remaining. Six rushes, 27 yards for Tim Buckley, who has really come to life in his second half. But Alcorn State is squarely in the game. One more score, and we'll probably see Trey Rutland back in at starting quarterback for Jackson State, who had been pulled after the first half, after that 21-0 lead.
Yeah, they're trying to protect him. He did have a banged-up shoulder from last week, and he came out of the game. But I tell you what, Trey Rutland has been the guy that's been pretty much manning the ship for the Jackson State Tigers down the stretch. They took him out early in the third quarter, but Mike Mosley has come in here and has thrown an interception for a touchdown and made some good plays when he first entered into the ball game. But now the Braves have climbed back in it. They're only down 12 with quite some time to play.
First and 10 for Alcorn State at the Jackson State 47-yard line. Buckley calls his own number, still on his feet, very close to a first down.
I think those are the type of plays you're going to have to see from Alcorn State if they're going to win this football game. You have to put this game on the back of Timothy Buckley and let him win the game, not just throwing the football, but also like this, design quarterback runs. This guy is a very good runner. He has four rushing touchdowns on the year already.
Pickup of nine. Ball now down at the 38-yard line of Jackson State. And you can feel people beginning to sit up on the edge of their seats. Runner slips. That's Pilcher. He'll lose a yard or two on that.
You know, you look at Jackson State's defense. I've been in games like this from a defensive player where you're pretty much doing a very good job as far as stopping the Alcorn State offense. They had a little bit of success running early on. You scored a touchdown, an interception return for a touchdown. You scored a safety. You're doing everything right defensively. But if you give up one score right here, you're right back into a dogfight. And so you have to play almost a perfect game if you're this JSU defense.
Alcorn State, 2 of 10 on third down conversions. This one is bandied up in the air. It was really anyone's ball. Should have been an interception maybe for Jackson State.
Once again, Marcellus Speaks putting up the pressure on Timothy Buckley. Two receivers standing in the same spot. That means someone made a mistake. Play really couldn't develop because of the early pressure. Now Alcorn State once again going for it on fourth down. Last time they went for it on fourth down, they was able to score a touchdown.
Fourth and three to go for the first down. Buckley under pressure again, gets it away. Very good defensive work.
Number 19, Marcus Jamison. Did a great job of getting his hand in there. That's just as good as a turnover when you stop a team on fourth down. Jackson State defense standing up, making plays.
Jackson State's defensive unit was pushed but did not break. Tigers will have the ball when we return to Jackson.
Most entertaining network, Verizon Wireless.
12-16 remaining in the fourth quarter. Jackson State leading Alcorn State in the Capital City Classic, 26-14. And we are now joined in our airy booth by Jimmy Smith, former Jackson State star, former NFL star. And this has been rivalry week because we thought it was over in the first half, and now Alcorn State's gotten back into it.
Yeah, this is what rivalry week is all about. You know, you think the game is out of hand. Jackson State had the game in hand, and the momentum shifted, and now we got a ball game.
Jackson State, your team with the ball, left side, running play. Luther Edwards doesn't get too far before he's tracked down. And Alcorn State, led by Robinson, who just made the tackle. They look like a different team, Jimmy, in the second half.
Yeah, they do. Like I said, a couple of turnovers, and definitely they've gotten a spark. And, you know, this band is playing, and so that's the spark right there, just having this band.
What do you remember about games like this?
I mean, the first thing that I remember is having the bands play throughout the whole entire game, and I think Eddie can second me on that. You know, when we got to the NFL, there are no bands, so that's one big part of the NFL that we miss.
Second and seven for Jackson State, the 43-yard line. Tigers lead it, but Alcorn State's defense has really stepped up over the last two series. Once again, Lee Robinson there defensively.
Now, of course, Jimmy, I mean, you played here at Jackson State, but you're a local guy. You went to high school here. Your dad played at Jackson State. Talk about some of the tradition that Coach Comegy has been able to bring back. Of course, you won the SWAC last year, and you're in the SWAC championship game once a year. That's what they expect around here.
Exactly. The expectations are very high. Coach Comegy has done an awesome job in uncovering the history of Jackson State. You know, we won many championships back in the 80s and 90s. Fortunately, I was a part of that, and he's done an excellent job in uncovering the history.
Third and six, Mosley going long. Nearly a spectacular catch made. Didn't quite hang on to it. Rashad Smith, the junior from Atlanta, was the intended receiver.
Now, Jimmy, go and tell me you would have caught this one, I know.
Yeah, that was money in the bank right there. I mean, if I could go back in the hand, you know, go back in time, you know, that would have been a touchdown right there.
Brett Bennett, who, as we noted, has had a very interesting day, will come on to punt. And Alcorn State will get another chance. Their defense holds. It's very nearly blocked again. It might have been tipped. Flag is down near the punter. So we may very well have running into the kicker.
Now, Jimmy, let's talk NFL a little bit. Of course, you know my Titans. You know, I played most of my career there, even though I played a couple years with you in Jacksonville. Yeah. They're 10-0. Yeah. What do you think about that? Think they can run the table the way New England
did? You know what I think about that. I hate the Titans.
I know you hate the Titans.
The Titans were always our nemesis. You know, Steve McNair was here earlier today. Mm-hmm. The Titans are doing good. You know, Fisher does an excellent job in not rebuilding but reloading from year to year.
Roughing the kicker on defense, number 29, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Yeah, see the roughing the kicker pass. Of course, Ernest Jones doesn't like that. Close call. Seemed like he was blocked, and I don't know. I think Jackson State might have got a break there. What you think?
Definitely got a break.
You will actually admit to that it was a break.
I will.
So Jackson State now with the lead has the ball in Alcorn State territory. Markers are down. Jimmy, talk about the intensity in this particular game. We'll hear from the referee first.
Prior to the snap. Snap. Infraction. On the offense. Number 69. 5-yard penalty. Replay. First down.
The intensity in this game, we touched upon the fact that Jackson State has already won its division. But the truth is, this game is still very, very important.
Very important game. You know, this game is one of those games that you set for bragging rights. You know, it's you throw all the stats and paperwork out of the window, and you bring your lunchbox to this game. And
Tigers lost five because of the penalty. 15 to go for the first. Left side, Edwards gets nowhere, and Lee Robinson was one of the men to get to him quickly. Along with Chukwuma Osula from Kansas City, Missouri.
So, Jimmy, tell me, going back to your times at Jackson State, of course, you guys won a couple of SWAC championships. What was your most memorable moment, you know, on the field playing for the for JSU Tigers?
Oh, correction, four swing championships.
I think it was three, Jimmy, because we beat you guys last year. Remember Alabama State?
Yeah, it was three. You're right.
Folks, I'm a referee up here.
Hey, I tell you what, you know, me and Jimmy go way back now. We both came out of Alabama State and Jack State the same year, and you played with the Jaguars, I played with the Titans. So we were always going against each other.
Exactly. I can even remember, Houston Oilers, and I was drafted by the Dallas Cowboys, yep, playing against each other in preseason.
Jimmy, how tough was he? Did he hit really hard?
Eddie Robinson hit really hard. You know, he's just an outstanding football player, all-around football player, both physically and mentally.
But he couldn't take you.
No, he couldn't handle me. When they put him out there on the coverage, he could not cover me.
I could cover him for the first 10 yards, then the speed was just too much. Most of the time, I'd have a deep safety to help me out. We would double cover Jimmy all the time. Yeah. And that was with the Titans. Our game plan was double cover Jimmy Smith and let Samari Rowe cover Keenan McCardo, and that's how we would win the game.
Exactly.
We were winning every time. Wasn't letting Jimmy Smith beat us deep.
Yeah, you're right. It was a very frustrating game every time we played the Titans.
Jackson State with the ball and the lead. Markers down again. Guys, both of you have played in games like this. Now, what happens when we start seeing multiple penalty flags and just things are going?
To the snap. Ball start. Number 76 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Replay. Third down.
Is it just that you're just so tense, no one wants to make the mistake to lose this big game?
I think it's a little bit of that. A lot of the times, it's players lose focus, you know, in the midst of a game. But a lot of it has to be probably jitteries, and no one wants to make that play that's going to be the deciding factor of the game.
Well, Jackson State, after that big lead, now is really just hanging on. Out of the shotgun on third down. Mosley, the backup, flushed out, rolling right, in trouble, gets it away. Alcorn State's defensive unit is just bringing pressure. That was Italy Etienne coming from a strong safety position on the blitz.
I don't know, Jimmy. I think you may need to get back down there and give those guys some words of encouragement offensively, because they're going backwards right now.
You're right. I wish I could strap on the shoulder pads and put on the shoulder.
I feel it. I can tell you, you're grunting. I'm like,
I know. I've been retired for 2.5 years now, and I think you can second that we'll never get used to being out of this game.
McLaurin feels a bit of punt. Right side has a bit of running room, gets out to the 30-yard line. And that's where Alcorn State will take over. Jimmy Smith, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
We'll see what happens with your Tigers, okay?
Thank you so much. Nice
being here. We'll return to Jackson after this.
Thanks, man.
Local retailer.
ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate, proud sponsor of college football, and the 75th Allstate Sugar Bowl. Are you in good hands? And Samsung, proud sponsor of ESPN Rivalry Week. That week continues here in Jackson, Mississippi. Alcorn State fans with much to cheer about right now, because their Braves are very much back into this game with 9:34 remaining here at Veterans Memorial Stadium. Tim Buckley out of the shotgun, flushed out. Ball is tipped, then caught by a secondary receiver. That's Emmanuel Arsenault, who makes the grab. That's a first down for Alcorn State. That's the kind of play you need when you're trying to get it going.
I tell you what, you'll take it. I mean, and it was there by far their longest pass completion of the day by Tim Buckley. And like you said, the ball was tipped. And there's number 181 Arsenault waiting there with receiving hands, and almost did a good job of breaking the tackle and turning that into a really big play for the Alcorn State Braves.
First down, Alcorn State now in Jackson State territory. Buckley under pressure again. Markers fly. There may be a holding call coming against Alcorn State.
Got a marker. 2-3.
That pickup on the previous play was 21 yards.
Holding. Number 74 on the offense, 10 yards from the previous spot. Replay, first down.
Alcorn State didn't need that.
Yeah, you can look at the right tackle there. Then get that tug on the jersey on the back. Hey, if you're not cheating, you're not trying. But the referees are doing a good job of catching those type of penalties. And it's tough when you're trying to block these Jackson State pass rushers when it's an obvious passing situation.
if you're not cheating, you're not trying.
Not cheating, you're not trying. Make them throw the flag.
It's an interesting mantra. First and 20, Alcorn State. Here comes the rush. Great defensive work by the Tigers. Anthony Atkins responding. Oh, about 14, 15 years ago, they had a pretty fair quarterback at Alcorn State, wore number 9, and set myriad passing records. Owns all of them at Alcorn State, and many of them in the swag. Steve McNair, a man that you were quite familiar with, Eddie.
Yeah, I tell you what, I played against him once in college, and we were lucky to catch him when he's a youngster, and we beat him that 1 year. Of course, he went on to win his next couple years, but he never lost in this Capital City Classic, won all 4 years.
Involved in the coin toss here earlier today. Buckley in trouble and running and goes down on a busted play. Marcus Jameson was there, number 19 defensively. How about these numbers?
Well, I think the biggest thing, he's first in everything. I mean, in 4 years. But, you know, he started as a true freshman, and he came onto the campus throwing the football. One time, I think he passed for 83 pass attempts in one game. You know, first in all divisions with the 400 career yard games. And, man, look at the total yards, 16,823 career passing yards.
And when he was playing this game, almost every game was almost sold out for Alcorn State. Buckley, with flags flying, throws it, completes it to Arsenault, but hang on. We'll wait until the third member of our announced team, George McCollum, lets us know what exactly transpired. Alcorn State's players indicating it's against Jackson State.
Pass on the defense, number 55, 15 yards. From in the run, automatic, first down.
Now that's a really big penalty. Goes against Anthony Atkins, the senior from Long Beach, California. And he's had a pretty good game, but that's a huge penalty.
Yeah, you can't make those type of mistakes. And Coach Comegy, I know he's like, man, what is going on with my team? Of course, they were playing extremely well in this football game, controlling the game. But these type of penalties, you just can't have.
Marcus fly again, just as the play begins to develop. Ball now at the 21-yard line.
Snap. False start, number 71 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, replay, first down.
It's Bronson Carvalho, so I guess it's hard to give a gift in this game because they want to give something back.
Yeah, it's the season of giving because both teams are having the penalties. It's something that you can't have. I mean, of course, this is Alcorn State's last game, but it's something that Coach Comegy, I'm sure, will work on. And he has a couple of things he's going to tighten up on. He's a very good, accomplished coach. He's won a lot at Tuskegee, won here at Jackson State. Already has one swag championship under his belt, so he'll get his Tigers ready to go.
Alcorn, 9 penalties, 72 yards so far in this game. Buckley, again, swarmed under defensively by Jackson State, and there is a flag down again. Look, if you're Rick Comegy right now, how are you feeling about this play? Hang on.
Offside on the defense. Number 95, 5 yards from the previous spot. Replay, first down.
So that's Larry Dennis.
Yeah, but that was a good job. Look at there, Larry Dennis. He just gets a jump start. I mean, he's trying to get there and get a sack, but you can't start early. And so that's what happened. I mean, that's a good call by the referees. And just a player trying to anticipate the snap count just a smidgen too early.
First down. Buckley on the pump. Fake keeps it. He gets out over the 19-yard line. Tim Buckley and the Alcorn State Braves have gotten back into this game after trailing 21-0 at halftime. Along with Eddie Robinson Jr., our entire ESPNU crew, we're here in Jackson, Mississippi, the Capital City Classic. Buckley with those 9 rushes for 43 yards. He has thrown a touchdown pass. Alcorn State, a heavy underdog coming into this game, but as we noted, it's rivalry week. This is one of the biggest touchdowns. Alcorn State. Elliot Moore, the senior from right here in Jackson.
Elliot Moore came into the game with 46 receptions and no touchdowns. That's his first touchdown of the year for Alcorn State, and it could not have come at a better time. The Alcorn State Braves have fought all the way back, and they are in this football game now.
Extra point is good. And just 5 points separate these two rivals. 26-21. Alcorn State has been on the move and has momentum on its side. Elliot Moore received that 18-yard touchdown strike from Tim Buckley, and it's now just a 5-point deficit. Six plays, 69 yards, 3 minutes, 46 seconds. And Alcorn State is all the way back in after trailing 26-0. We have 5:46 remaining in regulation here in Jackson, Mississippi. And this, folks, is why it's known as Rivalry Week. Jackson State's players having a hard time deciding just who would return the short kickoff. And that honor, as it were, finally went to Edward Lee, the fullback from Sunflower.
Now you look at the situation, it's pretty much man-to-man coverage with no middle safety. Elliot Moore is right here. He's going to run the slant route. And the thing, if you're the defender, you have to protect the middle of the field, because once he gets to the inside, look, nobody's there. There's no safety. That's a very easy throw and catch from Tim Buckley to number 8, Elliot Moore, his first touchdown reception of the year. And that's why he's so excited.
Michael Mosley brings the offensive unit back out on the field for Jackson State. On first down, keep it on the ground, but defensively, Alcorn State's players are there. Italy Etienne with the big play from that strong safety position.
You know, and I was just gonna say, if you're Jackson State, you have to get back to running the football, pounding the defense. But I tell you what, Alcorn State seems like they're not gonna let you run the football, and why would you? Because you have the backup quarterback in Mosley. He's showing some signs of rust. Why wouldn't you stack the line of scrimmage and force Jackson State to beat you by throwing the football?
Loss of 4, second and 14 from the 33-yard line. Jackson State. Pressure coming. Throws it long. Alcorn State looks like a totally different team now, and defensively, because they have points on the board now, they are really teeing off.
Yeah, they are. I mean, this defense has been playing good all day, and now they're playing in a situation, you know, where they can win this football game. And you talk about rivalry weekend. Usually a 2-9 football team ending the season right now, you were down 26-0, you're going to get ready for basketball season. But when it's a rivalry, you keep playing football. And look at the quarterback comparison. You have Trey Rutland, who is 8 of 10, no touchdowns, and even bigger, no interception. Mosley, only 4 of 16, 55 yards, and that big interception that was returned for a touchdown is the thing that really hurt the Tigers.
A major third down situation is coming, and there's a timeout on the field. Mosley came in to begin the second half. Rick Comagy inserted him. The starter, Trey Rutland, led them to a 21-0 halftime lead. Rutland nursing a sore shoulder. They have the SWAC championship game coming up on December 13th against a yet as unknown opponent. And the thinking was that with the game fairly in hand, that Mosley, who's played this year, can steward the rest of the way.
Yeah, I mean, it was a competition at one point between Mosley and Trey Rutland, so both of these guys have gotten a significant amount of playing time. Mosley played just a week ago when Trey Rutland couldn't finish the game because he had a nagging shoulder injury. So I think it was the correct call. You always have to protect the health of the kids first, and you have to look at the bigger picture if you do have a championship game in a couple weeks. So you put in Mosley, who's a backup that has playing time, but things just haven't gone well for the Tigers in the second half. And give credit to to Alcorn State and Coach Ernest Jones. They've never quit. I mean, offense couldn't get anything going in the first half. So you score on defense, you know, you score on another play, and now you're back into this football game and you have a chance to win.
Rutland looks like he's anxious to come back in. Key third down play. 14 to go for first. Mosley puts it up. Incomplete. So Alcorn State has an opportunity.
And keep in mind, the punt team has been a disaster for Jackson State. They already got one punt block, one the kicker couldn't get off, and so we'll see what happens now if Alcorn State decides to bring pressure. They've done a very good job of rushing the punter all afternoon.
Brett Bennett probably nervously waiting for the snap. High, does get it off. McLaurin fields a line drive. That's a free ball. Alcorn State will get it. As Javar's Tribune, number 21 was there to fall on the loose ball. So Rick Comagy, his defensive unit will have to do the job.
Yeah, just muffed the punt. Then it was kicked by the Jackson State player. Alcorn State. Give him credit. Most players would have tried to pick that up, but Javar Tribune, recognizing the situation, just does the smart thing and fall on the football. Now Alcorn State back on the field once again with Timothy Buckley, who's kind of got something going here in the fourth quarter.
Alcorn State beginning the drive at its own 19-yard line, trailing by five, 4:37 remaining. Buckley flushed out under pressure, throws it away. Smart play.
Now Buckley has done, well, Jackson State's defense has done a great job of controlling Timothy Buckley and his running ability. They really feared him more as a runner than a passer. And that defense has done a good job of pass rushing, staying in their lanes, and not allowing him to break the defense down by running outside the pocket. It'll be really important for them to continue that.
It's been really two different games. Jackson State controlling everything the first two quarters, and you see the second two, it's been Alcorn State coming to life. Second down and 10 from the 19. Buckley time to throw this time and overthrows his receiver. Edward Johnson was open on the near sideline.
Yeah, that's a play that you have to have right there.
That was a first down, too.
That was at least a first down, and depending on if Malcolm Palmer, number 26 for Jackson State, could have made the tackle, that thing could have gone the distance. So Buckley just needs to settle down and get a first down on this play. And I tell you what, if he has an open lane to run, he needs to take advantage of his ability to run the football. The biggest thing now is just get a first down.
Buckley has delivered on some big third and fourth down conversions in this game. Out of the shotgun, crowd on its feet. Buckley, time to throw. It is tipped and caught again for the second time in as many drives. Alcorn State has a play that is tipped by the initial receiver and caught by the secondary one. This time it's Chris Williams who hauls in the pass for the first down.
I tell you what, these kids are playing so hard on both sides of the ball. I mean, they do a great job of covering on the back end. They get pressure. You do everything right defensively. Your player tips it in the air, which is usually good for the offense. But then number four, Chris Williams, gets the gift and another first down by the Alcorn State Braves, who can do no wrong in the fourth quarter.
A 21-yard pickup sets up first down at its own 40-yard line for Alcorn State. 3:55 remaining in regulation. Buckley, time to throw, going across the middle, has a receiver, another first down. It's Williams, move the chains.
Tim Buckley is on fire. I mean, this guy is playing with so much swagger and confidence now. It looks like a totally different player from the first half. And keep in mind, he was even taken out of the game for a series or two to start the third quarter. They replaced him with Tony Hobson, who was ineffective. You put Buckley back in, and he responds to the coach's challenge and is now looking like a different guy.
Pickup of 18, ball now at the 42-yard line of Jackson State. Tigers coming with the pressure. Buckley has a man open who has his man beat, but he overthrows Johnson this time on the far sideline.
I tell you what, this is going to be a Capital City Classic game that they're going to talk about for the ages. I mean,
regardless of who wins the football game, both of these programs and these teams and coaches are just playing extremely hard. I mean, they're putting it all out on the field. There's no way you can tell me that Alcorn State is a 2-9 football team, and you would never know that Jackson State is the Eastern Division champ the way they're playing with much enthusiasm to win this football game.
Second down. And 10 from the 42. Buckley, plenty of time to throw. In and out of the hands of his receiver, that's Williams.
Brings up third down.
Defensively there, the Tigers responding.
You know, we talked with Coach Comegy yesterday, and one thing he said is my team has been battle tested. When we started off, you know, 1-4 and things weren't going well, that we really came together as a coaching staff and as a team. And he said, you know what, if we get into a dogfight, I like the chances of my team pulling it out in the end. And he said he wasn't so sure in the beginning of the year, but he didn't expect this today.
Third and 10. Buckley, this time he's going down. Big number 92.
Dennis Coit. I mean, this guy does all of the dirty work for this JSU defense, so Marcus Bernard and Marcellus Spees can have all of the fun. But look at the push that he gets in the middle of the field right here. He's just keep pushing up the field. And that big guy there, I mean, he's a player. I mean, he's more of a run stopper. But a lot of those sacks that the defensive ends get is because he's commanding a double team in the middle of the field.
Loss of 9. That was 6'1" and 320 pounds coming at Buckley.
Fourth down opportunity for the Braves.
Fourth and 19 and the ball game for all intent and purpose. Buckley under pressure. He goes down again. It's the big fella one more time.
Big Dennis Coit.
Dennis Coit. That may have done it.
That JSU defense, they have been great all year long. Look at Big Dennis Coit right here. He's a nose tackle. He just keeps pushing and pushing and doesn't give up. He's commanding the double team every time. And that's what they talked about yesterday, is that he realizes he can't beat Buckley in the foot race, but when he can't get pressure on the quarterback, he goes lateral, sideline to sideline, and he just takes the good angle to get that sack.
Jackson State takes over, has to pick up a first down. It's Luther Edwards. Out of bounds is not where you want to go. You want that clock moving.
Yeah, you do.
If you're Jackson State. This will close out the season for Alcorn State regardless. As we noted, Jackson State still has that SWAC championship game on December 13th in Birmingham. And look who is back in at quarterback, number 7, Trey Rutten. That's what this game means to this team.
Well, it means that to these fans also. I mean, they want to win this game.
Keep it on the ground. That's a first down by Edwards. He's finally corralled and brought down by Javaris Tribune, but that will move the chains for Jackson State as we are nearing the 2-minute mark in regulation.
It does a good job of going off tackle. And that's what you want right now. You have to have your big guys up front just to play tough. It's no fair dodging. We're going to be running the football. The whole stadium knows it. And can you stop us?
First down. Once again, it's Edwards, who already has 78 yards rushing, and he's down near the 10-yard line, crowd on its feet, and you sense that they want another touchdown for good measure.
Oh, absolutely.
Randy Carter there defensively.
Look at your big fullback here. This is what you have to have. If you want to have an effective running play, he's going to come down here and throw the lead block to get everything started. And this is just his basic man-on-man football. It's no fair dodging. My fullback's going to block your linebacker, and we're coming off that play to get a first down. And that's what you have to have to close out a football game if you want to be a championship team.
Tigers keep it on the ground. Alcorn State, which had all three of its timeout will probably begin to use them now. There's the first one.
Well, keep in mind, this is still a five-point game. If you can hold the Jackson State Tigers to a field goal, I'm talking about if you're Alcorn, you still have a chance to do something. But look at the close losses. Five losses by 7 points or less. I mean, they've competed hard in this division. The only team that they got blown out against was Grambling State early on in Prairie View, which is the two best teams in the West. So, I mean, all in all, Alcorn State, and they're playing hard. And you really have to like down 26-0. I mean, I know there's no such thing as moral victories in football, but you have to give those guys a lot of credit for getting back into this football game.
Ernest Jones, at the beginning of our telecast when we first came on, you heard him in the locker room imploring those players to play for pride. It is within you, and you can get it done. He may be the perfect person right now to resurrect this program.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, because most 2-9 teams, when you're down 26-0 at the half, it's the last game of the year, it's cold. I mean, you go in and get the basketballs out. Football season's over. You're not really concerned about finishing off the game. But, I mean, these guys played hard the entire football game, especially that defense. We need to stand up and have another big play right now.
2nd and 9. Jackson State with the lead, trying to ice it, put it away. 1:14 remaining in regulation. Trey Rutland has been reinserted into the starting lineup at quarterback. Edwards banging his way up the middle, running into Italy Etienne, who's had quite a game defensively from his strong safety position.
And I think Trey Rutland is in this game more to manage the clock and maybe have a threat to pass the football. But honestly, I think Coach Comegy, they want that big offensive line to control the ball and run this clock out.
Another timeout call by Alcorn State. Let's finish up with our E-Rob Awards for the year in the SWAC. And the Coach of the Year is, drum roll please.
Yeah, I mean, I have to go with Coach Rob Broadway at Grambling State. His team is the only team that's undefeated in conference play right now. Of course, they have that big game against Southern. But he only had 6 seniors on his football team. He traveled with 40 to 45 freshmen and sophomores, and he's been able to get it done week to week, and now they have a chance to get into that championship game.
And you look at all the awards handed out by you this year.
Yeah, I mean, and the one thing I have to give him, the Prairie View Panther football team. I mean, I think they may be the best football team in the West, even though they had that loss to Grambling. At 9-1, Coach Henry Frazier, that's the best record from a Prairie View football team since 1961. So they get the best team award, and I like everything else. You know, of course, Brian Lee offense, Beans defensively, and Coach Broadway for the job he's done with all those young players.
Amazing season, Coach Frazier at Prairie View this year. Quite a job getting the A&M Panthers. It's funny, people forget the losing streak now. They are back. Jackson State keeping it on the ground. Edwards running into traffic. And he's gang tackled and put down. Leading the way, Marcus Cooper, senior from Laurel, number 44.
You know, and ordinarily I would say with this Jackson State defense, hey, this game is done, they should have it in the bag. But even if they connect on this field goal and take an 8-point lead, it's been so many wild things that happened today with the tip passes going to Alcorn State. Seemed like they're getting all of the breaks in the second half. I think this is one that you have to look at all the way to the end.
We're in Jackson, Mississippi. It's the Capital City Classic, 33rd meeting. It's Rivalry Week on ESPN. Jackson State and Alcorn State. Jackson State led 21-0 at halftime. Alcorn State came back, scoring point after point after point to get back into it. And coming up next, Duke and Virginia Tech, ACC matchup in Blacksburg, Virginia. We'll get you to that as soon as we are done here. But Ernest Jones and his underdog Alcorn State Braves have really shown themselves proud in this second half. Trey Rutland, just to show you how things change, after that 21-0 lead, he took a seat. We thought he was done, but they brought him back out in that last series. Now on with the field goal is Eric Perry. Special teams have been very, very interesting in this game. It's blocked! So Alcorn State still has life with 52 seconds remaining. And Rick Comegy is well aware of what could happen over the next 52 ticks.
Yeah, it just seemed like he didn't get a lot of height on this kick. I mean, Perry is a very good field goal kicker. And yeah, that ball was kicked like helmet level. He just didn't get enough height on it, didn't strike it well. But hey, Jackson State, that defense is going to be put to the test one more time, and we'll see if they're up to the task.
It was Joe Keyes, number 92 for Alcorn State, 6'3", 240 pounds, that got his hands up and knocked it down.
But I tell you what, if Jackson State can hold on and get this victory, this would be a great teaching tool going into that SWAC championship game, the importance of closing out football games and realizing you have to play 60 minutes.
Alcorn State ball at the 21-yard line. Buckley crossed the middle. He was looking for Elliott Moore. And defensively, good work by Dominic Johnson, the All-America, whose name we have not called much at all, number six.
Jackson State, you just let that front four. I mean, you have Marcus Bernard with 14 sacks, Sam Washington, big Dennis Coit, number 92. He just got two sacks on the drive before. Just let that front four pass rush, and everyone else just play zone and make tackles.
Second down. Alcorn State down by five. 48 seconds remaining in regulation. Wide open was Chris Williams. Ball may have been thrown a little behind him.
Yeah, Buckley seems like he's pressing a little bit, and it's tough. I mean, this is a good defense. You have to hit those wide open guys and hopefully get out of bounds or get a first down and stop this clock. And weird things have been going on all day long today. Good things for the Braves. We'll see if they can pull out another big play.
Well, we've seen two plays in this quarter where there's been a tip from the primary receiver and the secondary caught it for a big first down. Third down, Buckley under pressure, releases, has his man on the far sideline. That's Moore.
Play results on a first down.
First down, Alcorn State. 39 seconds remaining in regulation.
Yeah, with no timeouts, at some point, Alcorn State's going to have to try to take a shot deep. Even if the man is covered, give your offensive guy a chance to make a big play.
Buckley has Williams in the near sideline, and he's wrestled down. Ends up out of bounds. Marcel Young there defensively.
No, they're running the clock. They're saying his forward progress was stopped, and the clock is still moving. They'll have to hurry up.
Down to 25 seconds. Second down. Buckley spikes it. That'll give him a moment to regroup. They have to take a shot at the end zone.
They have to take a shot deep. They have to take a shot and maybe get a good 30 or 40 yards and then start trying to toss one or two into the end zone, and maybe you get a big play. But this Jackson State defense, these are good, disciplined players, very talented. They've been playing well the entire year and even today. I mean, a couple of things that have happened and hasn't been their fault, quite frankly. And so, it's going to be tough to try to score in the defense in this situation with the talent level that Jackson State has on the field.
Reminder, we'll get you to Blacksburg, Virginia for Virginia Tech and Duke as soon as this one is over. Out of the shotgun is Buckley on third down. Looking long. He caught it! Emmanuel Arsenault! Wow!
And with 13 seconds left, you probably have two plays in which to go into the end zone.
Down to the Jackson State 26-yard line.
Jackson State, you have to defend the goal line, of course. But this is a great throw and catch. I mean, he put this ball in the perfect position. And Timothy Buckley, I mean, he'll be back next year. This guy has really grown up in this football game.
First down. Buckley, time to throw, across the middle, incomplete. What a 43-yard play, though, that was. Nine seconds remaining, Buckley holding his midsection.
Jackson State calling the timeout just to settle their defense down, make sure you have everyone lined up in the correct position.
Saw Buckley's numbers, waving off any suggestion of assistance. This has been some finish.
This has been a great game. I mean, this is one that has been so entertaining. Both of these teams are playing so hard, and what a comeback by Alcorn State. Down 26-0, not giving up. But then look at Jackson State. I mean, these guys have taken it to the limit, but they didn't give up. They kept fighting through adversity, something that Coach talked about all year long. The Tigers have been able to bounce back and recover from adversity. And I tell you what, if they can hang on and win this game, it really poises them to play well in that SWAC championship game.
Virginia Tech and Duke are underway in Blacksburg. As soon as we are done here in Jackson, we'll get you to that game. no score between the Blue Devils and the Hokies. Eddie Robinson Jr., our entire ESPNU crew, I'm Dwayne Ballin. It has been our pleasure to bring you this one. Alcorn State has made quite the game of this one.
And as the temperature is dropping today, I don't think anyone is cold because all of the fans are standing up cheering. This has been a great afternoon for football with this Capital City Classic.
9 seconds remaining. Jackson State fans chanting defense, Alcorn State fans chanting offense. Buckley, time to throw, gets it away towards the end zone. Incomplete. 2 seconds remain on the clock.
And Emmanuel Arsenault was so close to catching that football. I mean, you're talking about another yard or two, and he may be able to make a great catch in the back of the end zone. Buckley doing a great job of just getting the ball out of his hand. Look how close he is to getting to that football. If you're Jackson State, you want to back everybody up into the end zone. I mean, anything that's caught within the field of play, the time will definitely run out.
This will be it. Buckley hauls it towards the end zone. It is knocked down. That's it. Jackson State survives and wins the Capital City Classic. 26-21. Rick Comagie now heads on to the SWAC Championship game in Birmingham. Once again, our final score from Memorial Stadium in Jackson. Jackson State 26, Alcorn State 21. What a performance by Alcorn State to get back into it after trailing 21-0 at halftime. But Jackson State's defense in the end proved to be too much. Jackson State now improves to 7-4 overall. Alcorn State closes the year 2-10. Our final score once again, 26-21 Jackson State. For more information, log on to your home for the finest in college sports. For Eddie Robinson, I'm Dwayne Ballin saying so long from Jackson. Now let's head out to Dave Armstrong and Larry Coker in Blacksburg for Duke and Virginia Tech.